Hello, I'm Bob Krist, contributing editor and photographer at National Geographic Traveler magazine and travel columnist for Outdoor Photographer magazine. I'll be your host for this Nikon School program, a hands-on guide to creative lighting. It's packed with valuable information, demonstration, and instruction to get you shooting as soon as possible. We'll talk about light itself, review some of the basics of lighting for photography, and follow up with an in-depth overview and demonstration of the outstanding Nikon Creative Lighting System. I'm also excited to have renowned photographer and colleague Joe McNally joining me. Joe and I will venture into the field to capture real-life images in a diverse set of scenarios. So let's get started. As we explore the many facets of light, it becomes clear that light is the single most important tool that a photographer has to work with. In fact, the very meaning of the word photography is drawing or writing with light. Now, the more you understand about light, how to use it, how to modify it, and what subject matter looks good in what type of light, the stronger your photographs will become. You know, a photo editor friend of mine at National Geographic Traveler magazine once told me that he'd rather look at a photograph of a line of hanging laundry shot in beautiful light than a picture of the Taj Mahal shot in dull, ugly light. But what is it that makes light beautiful, or dull, or ugly, or magical? These are all very abstract words that may not help us understand the nature of light or how we can work with it. We need to break the subject down into more concrete terms. Now, even though we're going to be discussing the use of flash and the Nikon Creative Lighting System of Speedlights, let's start by talking about the sun. It's our main, well, really, it's our only source of natural light. And even though there's only one sun, at least in this solar system, there are a myriad of variations of the light coming from it. Now, in order to understand how to use your flash to its greatest potential, you've got to first understand the basic variables of available or natural light, because the same principles apply. Now, we can break these variables down into three basic categories. The direction of light: is it coming from the front, the side, behind, below, or above the subject? The color of light: is it warm or cool, orange or blue? And the quality of light: is it hard-edged and specular with sharp, deep shadows, or soft and diffused with open or even non-existent shadows? Learn to match the right variables within these three categories to the appropriate subject matter, and you're taking a giant step forward in your development as a photographer. If photography means drawing with light, then these are your tools. First, let's look at the direction that the light is coming from in relation to the subject. Now, why is this important? Because the world we live in is three-dimensional. The imaging sensor that we record on and the paper that we print on are only two-dimensional. The only way we can capture that feeling of depth on our two-dimensional media is by the interplay of light and shadow. Shadows are as important as light, and where you place them means everything. Hence the importance of the direction of the light. Now, the Italian painters of the Renaissance had a word for this interplay of light and shadow to create the illusion of depth. They called it chiaroscuro. Now, the color of light is also important, and yes, daylight comes in a variety of colors. In the early morning and late afternoon, the longer rays of the red-orange spectrum are more prevalent, and that's when you get that lovely warm light that's so favored by landscape photographers. During twilight, you get a bluish quality of light, as you do in deep shade. At high noon, sunlight is at its most neutral, or white. But why is the color of light important for us to consider as photographers? Because the color of the light directly affects the mood of your photo, and that affects the viewer. Reddish-orange tones can convey a feeling of warmth and well-being. Bluish tones feel cool. Greenish light, the kind put out by fluorescents, makes people look sick. And pure white light, such as that at high noon, can be accurate, but a little clinical. So the color of light affects the way the viewer reacts to your photograph. Finally, let's look at the quality of the light. Specular light, the kind that comes from the sun on a clear, bright, sunny day, is sharp and contrasty with deep, clearly defined shadows. Diffused light is the kind of light that occurs when a large layer of clouds passes between the sun and the subject, or if the subject is in shade. Because the light is broader than the little orb of the sun, it's softer and lower in contrast, with open shadows or none at all. That's because the larger the light source is in relation to the size of the subject, the softer the light will be. In a cloudless sky, the sun is a pinpoint of light. On a cloudy day, your light source is now that giant blanket of clouds, and it's a much softer light with little or no shadow at all. Now, the key to creating a strong photograph is to match the subject matter to the appropriate type of light, and you're on your way. Let's look at a couple of situations and analyze the light quality to help you see how these three elements come together. Landscapes look great with a crisp low side light, the type you encounter in the early morning or the later afternoon. Why? Well, for a number of reasons. First, the direction, where the shadows can aid in creating that sense of depth. The quality is crisp and undiffused, so the contours of the landscape will be sharply etched to further the feeling of depth. And finally, the light color of the longer rays in the spectrum in the early morning and late afternoon are warm and beautiful. Now, portraits and people shots also look great with the light coming from the side to give a roundness to the subject. But usually, it's a softer, more diffused light quality that is much more flattering to the human face and figure than harsh specular light. As for the color, almost any picture of a person will look healthier and more pleasing in a slightly warmer than neutral color palette. That good old golden light of early morning or late afternoon again. Okay, at this point, you may be asking yourself, if we have natural light, beautiful natural light from the sun in a myriad of configurations, why do we need anything else? Well, there are at least three reasons. First, if there's not enough light, the natural light is too low to use, you need to supplement it. This might occur indoors, at night, or even deep in shadows. Secondly, sometimes the actual range of contrast that natural light presents is too broad to record on our digital imaging sensors or our pieces of film. That's right, our eyes are amazing optical instruments. In contrasty conditions, such as those on a sunny day with bright highlights and deep shadows, they can actually see more detail in those extreme highlights and shadows than our cameras can record. Now, this is true of all current digital camera sensors and film. So, we need to lower that contrast by opening up the shadows to make them more penetrable and recordable by our cameras, either by using a flash to fill in but not eliminate the shadows with light, or some kind of physical reflector to do the same thing. Now, the third and possibly most powerful reason to go beyond working strictly with natural light is that we can actually transform the mood and look of our subject matter by using our speed lights. We can create dramatic photographs where the natural lighting conditions are either dull, dark, or downright ugly by adding the light from one or more speed lights. By mastering even just a few of the features of Nikon speed lights, we can go from merely taking snapshots to creating wonderful photographs. And Nikon speed lights make it easy. Over the years, flash technology has evolved steadily and has become more and more versatile. The creative use of flash is no longer just in the hands of a small number of experienced professionals. Today, we have the Nikon Creative Lighting System, engineered to integrate seamlessly and wirelessly with your Nikon camera to easily create wonderful flash photographs. What's different about flash? So far, we've been discussing all the similarities between flash and natural light in terms of the quality, direction, and color of the two light sources. But there are a couple of significant differences. The first and biggest difference is that while we can control the amount of natural light that hits the camera's sensor using a combination of aperture and shutter speed, flash is essentially controlled by only the aperture setting. This might be a good time for a quick review of the terms. Aperture, or f-stop, describes the size of the opening in the lens diaphragm that lets in the light. a wide or fast aperture, say f2, f2.8, or f4, lets in more light than a smaller aperture like f16, f11. Yes, the bigger the number, the smaller the aperture. Now, besides controlling the amount of light coming in through the lens, the aperture also affects the depth of field in a photograph. A wide aperture has less depth of field than a small aperture. Because the duration of the light that a flash emits is so short, beyond 1/30,000th of a second, the shutter speed of the camera, that is, the amount of time that the shutter curtains are open, doesn't really affect the amount of flash hitting the sensor or film plane. The only real way that shutter speed affects our flash is that we've got to make sure that the shutter curtains are wide open at the moment the flash goes off, so that they synchronize. The fastest shutter speed that a camera can successfully do this with a given flash is called the sync speed. It varies with the camera body. For example, some cameras can sync up to 1/250th of a second and others at 1/200th of a second. Our Nikon Speedlights and cameras also have a special high-speed sync function where the flashlight pulses quickly and allows us to synchronize at much higher shutter speeds, even as high as 1/8,000th of a second. We'll show you how this works, its strengths and its limitations, a little later in this video. But for now, it's just important to remember that to use flash in most situations, you have to make sure that you're shooting at the camera's sync speed or slower. Yes, that's right. Any shutter speed that is slower than the maximum sync speed can also be used with Nikon Speedlights. And it's a technique called slow sync flash that we'll also be looking at later. So to recap, the amount of flash that hits the camera's imaging sensor is controlled by the aperture and not the shutter speed. Shutter speed is only important in terms of the sync speed and whether or not you want to blend in some of the ambient light using slow sync flash. Now, the second important difference between natural light and flash is that with flash, the intensity of the light falls off very quickly as the subject's distance from the light source increases. Now, you've probably seen this effect in your own flash photography. Now, there's a term in physics to describe this rapid light falloff, and it's called the inverse square law. But what you need to remember is that your flash illumination will fall off quickly, so you can't light subjects at multiple distances with the light from just one flash. So let's work with some sample lighting setups to show you how the basic variables of direction, quality, and color of your light can be used. We'll also look at how to set up our speed lights for seamless off-camera work. All right, let's start shooting. We're working today with Taylor. She's a talented young actress from Rhode Island. Taylor, just sit right there. And here we go. Now, this is the way most of us use our flashes the first time. We stick it in the hot shoe and we aim it directly at our subject. Now, there's nothing wrong with that. It produces a very frontal, very specular type of light. But is it the most flattering light? Well, not necessarily. It's kind of clinical. It's the kind of light they use to take your passport picture or your driver's license. It'll work, but it's not the most flattering that we can do. But let's just see what it does. Even with a beautiful young lady like Taylor, here we go. Okay. All righty. Let's see what we have. Okay, there she is. And as promised, it's frontal light. The shadows are behind her. The background has fallen down very much. It's very dark. We do see a lot of detail in her face, but it's a harsh light. We can see these strong shadows in her neck here. So let's see what we can do to improve that. Okay, the easiest and simplest thing you can do is to diffuse the light, change the quality of the light. Now we're going to turn a specular light source into a diffused light source by simply aiming it up at the ceiling. Now, hopefully you've got a ceiling that's 10 feet or below. It's got to be white because it'll pick up the color. But let's see what happens simply by turning the flash up towards the ceiling and creating a larger light source. Okay, Taylor, here we go. Let's see what that does for us. Now the light is coming from above. It's a much softer light quality, But now we've run into some other problems. Now the shadows, instead of being behind her, are kind of underneath. And look what it does. It picks up some shadows under the bottom of her eyes here, under her cheeks. The shadows are not where we want them. So what can we do? Well, I'm going to change the direction of the light. And I'm going to do that by using a remote flash. First, I'm going to reduce and turn off the main output of this light and use it only as a controller. Then, I'm going to take my remote light and set it up at about a 45 degree angle to Taylor. Now, why am I going at a 45 degree angle? Well, it's going to create a wrap. It's going to create a change from the highlight to the shadow. And remember, we do want shadows in photography because it's that interplay of highlight and shadow that gives a sense of depth to our photographs. So we want shadows, but we want to put them exactly where we want them and not where they fall just by chance. And now, the only light that's coming from here is a pulse that controls that. So here we go, Taylor, there we go. Ah, that looks great. Okay. Now we're starting to see something going on with the direction of the light. Notice how the highlights wrap around from highlight to shadow. We've got that nice triangle of highlight over here. The direction is getting where we want it to be, but the quality is still pretty specular. It's still a pretty harsh light, especially to photograph young people in. So our next step is going to be to soften that light. So what can we do for that? We might look for another found surface that's larger, in this case, a nice white wall. And I'm going to take that light and I'm going to aim it right here. Now, the direction is going to be from the side again. The quality of the light is going to be diffused because look at the size of this light source compared to the size of the flash reflector. So the light's going to be a lot softer. So let's take a shot and see where we go with this one. Okay, Taylor, here we go. All righty. Okay. Beautiful soft light wrapping around her face like that. We've got nice broad highlights, really, really nice quality of light. Just wraps around there. We still have the problem of the background. We're going to deal with that. We can't neglect our backgrounds. We're losing some separation here, but the quality of the light on her face is just gorgeous. It's soft, it's glowy. That's what we're aiming for. Now, the problem with using found light sources like walls is, well, you don't often find them where you need them. And also, sometimes you find them and they're the wrong color. Now, let's take a quick look at what happens when you bounce off the wrong color found source. Here's a red wall. What's going to happen here if we bounce off a source that's not a neutral color like white or gray? Well, let's take a look. Okay, Taylor, that's it, just like that. It's easy to see that you've got to work with a neutral light source for bouncing, otherwise you're in deep trouble. This is a very mysterious, very moody shot, but it's not exactly what we're looking for a nice beauty headshot. So remember, white or light gray, something neutral. Found light sources are not going to work for us. What can a photographer do when the ceilings are too high or they're black or gray or the walls are not in the right place? Well, most of us prefer to use something like an umbrella. The umbrella is a larger light source. It's very portable. You can use it in a number of ways. You can bounce into it, or you can shoot through it. Now, most of the time when we're shooting portraits, we prefer to shoot through the umbrella. Why? As I bring this closer to Taylor, it becomes a larger light source in relation to her. If I bounce into it like this, it's a little farther away, it becomes smaller. So the direction of the light is coming from the side, the angle is 45 degrees, but now it's a diffused light source and it's controllable. Okay, Taylor, here we go, looking right at me. Now we're seeing the beautiful wraparound light. It's soft, it's glowy, it's controllable. And we're getting a little bit of spill on the background. We're picking up a little more separation from the background. Not enough, but a little more. We still have a problem here, I think, with some deep shadows. This is a very mysterious kind of shot, but I think for a younger subject, you want to open it up. You want to get a little more fill. Keep in mind that your eyes can see a lot more detail in shadows than our digital chips can. Our eyes are remarkable instruments, and they have a much wider range of tonal recognition than any digital chip has to date. So we might want to open up those shadows just a little. We still want shadows, but we want them to be penetrable. How can we do that? Well, we could add another light, but I prefer to use a reflector. A reflector, simply a white source. These are foldable reflectors that I can carry in the back of my camera bag anywhere. And I'm going to put that right on the shadow side here. You'll see this will catch the light coming from the umbrella. It'll bounce it back. It'll open up the shadows, but it won't override them. So let's see what the simple addition of a reflector does for this photograph. Okay, Taylor, you're looking good. There we go. All right. Let's see what that fill card does for us. Now we've got a beautiful wrap from highlight to shadow. The shadow side is nice and open. There's a glow there, catch light in her eyes. This is really starting to shape up. If I'm looking for something I want to improve on this, the background is still a little dark. We're losing the separation between her dark hair and the background and the dark blue down here. So now I need to create some kind of separation without losing this beautiful quality, this beautiful wraparound quality, the soft light. And the way we're going to do that is we're going to add a little light right onto the background. The background is too dark in our photograph, and that will lighten it up and separate it from her. So what I'm going to do is aim that light so it comes right, hits right behind where she is, and illuminates that portion of the backdrop. Okay, here we go. Looking good. I'm going to try this with the background light, and wow. Okay, that's really starting to shape up nicely. See how now, with the background light, we've got beautiful separation. Everything is clearly outlined. We've got that nice wrap of light, soft light, the main light, the fill card, the background light. It has a real feeling of dimension. She kind of pops out from the frame. It looks terrific. And honestly speaking, you could stop right here and you'd have a beautiful portrait or headshot here. But I'm seeing one little other thing I'd like to mess around with a little. And that is, I'd like to bring out a little detail in her hair there. She's got beautiful hair that you can see when it catches a highlight, it just glows. So I would like to get a little bit more of a kick over here on the shadow side of her hair. Now, funnily enough, the light I'm going to use is another light aimed right at her, and it is sometimes called a kicker or a hair light or a rim light, any one of those three terms. And the rim that it's going to light is her shoulder and her hair here. So I am going to take a third light now and try for further separation. Now, the thing to remember when you're working with a hair light or a rim light is that you want to concentrate the light. You don't want it spilling all over. So I want a specular source, and I want it to be very concentrated. So I'm going to zoom the head out a little to 200 millimeters and aim it right at her hair there. All right, so now I've got the background light, I've got a rim light or a kicker, and I've got the main soft light and a fill card. Let's see what kind of result that gives us. Okay. Bingo. There it is. There it is. Notice how that third light, that kicker, just puts a little sparkle on the shadow side of her hair. We get a nice little backlighting on the shoulder here. Also over here, a little more separation on the shadow side. This just works beautifully, I think. And that third light just adds the separation. Let's see if we can go back and call up the other shot here. You see the difference. We've got the dark here. It looks fine, but by just bringing out that kicker light, we're just adding that little added dimension there. So there you have it. Simple three-light portrait. Started with a flash on camera and a slow build using Nikon Speedlights to create a professional looking beauty portrait, just as easy as that. Now, an important thing to remember when you're working with flash is that while there are two ways for our cameras to control available light coming into the camera, the shutter speed and the aperture, the amount of flash that hits our subject is really controlled only by the aperture. The way that shutter speed affects flash is in terms of synchronizing the opening of the shutter with the burst of the flash. Now, the fastest possible shutter speed that allows the flash to fire when the shutter curtains are fully opened is called the sync speed. Nikon cameras can sync in normal mode up to 1/250th of a second. But you're not required to work at the camera's top sync speed all the time. Any speed that is slower than the top sync speed will also work. Now, when we shoot below the top sync speed, it's called slow sync flash, and it's a very useful technique. Okay, let's take a look. We've got the one light again through the umbrella, and we want to get some separation from the background. Or we want to include the background, but it's simply too large to light. Now, this might occur if you were doing an environmental portrait in a large office or any large space, like this studio, for instance. How can we reveal that background light? Well, keeping in mind that our flash exposure is only controlled by the aperture, and also that flash tends to fall off very quickly. In other words, it doesn't travel all that far. What we can do is use the aperture to control our flash exposure here on our subject in the foreground. We have f/5.6 set on the camera, and the available light exposure for the background is 1/4 of a second. The flash is going to light the subject, then the shutter is going to stay open a little longer to burn in the background, and the result should be a seamless integration of flash and available light. Now, it's important to remember that if you are using slow sync, the shutter speed might drop to a speed at which you cannot handhold your camera steadily. So a tripod or a VR image stabilization lens will come in handy with this technique. Okay, let's see what we get. I'm going to shoot this first shot at 1/250th of a second, the top sync speed of the camera, and let's see what we get. Alrighty. Okay, there's the shot, and what we have is a perfectly exposed subject, but look at all that darkness behind her. There's no sense of the background whatsoever. And this is the way most of our flash shots look when we shoot at the top or higher sync speeds. It just loses all sense of the background, especially if the background is in low light. So for an environmental portrait or almost any kind of family shots, you want a sense of the background, the setting. How can we achieve that? Okay, we're going to try to drop that shutter speed a little lower to register the low light in the background. I'm going to drop this shutter speed to 1/4 of a second, and we'll take another shot, and we'll see what that slower shutter speed does. There it is, bingo. Now all of a sudden the background becomes lit and blended perfectly. We've got the perfectly exposed foreground, the subject in the foreground, and we have a great sense of her environment. Now, this is the great technique to use for environmental portraiture or almost any kind of family situations. You always want a sense of place when you're shooting people. You don't want them floating in darkness. So here it is, slow sync flash. It's a great technique. Now remember, all light has color. And remember too that Murphy wrote the law that rules the photographer's universe. We're often asked to work in situations where the color of the light is not ideal. One situation and one type of light that we often find ourselves in is fluorescent light. And we're going to find ourselves in fluorescent more and more as these low energy bulbs are being mandated into usage. Now fluorescent light is very cost efficient, but it's very ugly. Why? Well, because it does not emit a full spectrum of light. It is very, very green. Now, we mentioned before how light affects your emotions, the emotions of the viewer. We've seen that nice, warm light looks rich and inviting. But if we had shot this same scene in a fluorescently lit room, it gives that sickly green color that you associate with hospital emergency rooms. So what can we do? Let's take a look. We're going to shoot our first shot just the way we see it. Okay, Taylor. Okay, let's see what we've got. Oh boy, okay. We've got that very heavy cast of green. We've got the wrong color balance. We have daylight balance set for the in the camera, but our main sources of light are fluorescent. Fluorescent is very green, so the color of the light is way off. You can see the green highlights in her hair, you can see the green in the background, but also it's very contrasty, so the quality of the light isn't there either. Okay, I think I can clean this up by using a remote flash. Yes, I'm going to turn my flash back on. I'm going to move it in again a little closer here to get that nice three-quarter light, and hopefully we're going to clean up that green. Now I'm going to turn my master flash back on as the controller here, and we're going to take a shot and see what that does. All right. Oh, nice. Now we've got a very clean skin tone here. She looks great, but look, there's still that leftover green highlight from the fluorescent here, and the background is still green. That's because we're still working in daylight white balance. What we've got to do to clean up that green is to change our white balance from daylight to fluorescent. Now, that'll clean up all that green. So let's try that, and let's see what happens. So I take my white balance, I go from daylight to fluorescent, and we're going to take another shot. That looks great, Taylor. There we go. Okay. Let's see. All right. Now, we see what messing around with changing the color is a kind of a house of cards here. By changing to the fluorescent light balance, we've cleaned up the background light, we've cleaned up the highlights, but now look how magenta her skin tone is. Why? Well, remember that the flash is balanced for daylight. It's a different color than the fluorescence. So we've corrected for the fluorescence by adding a little magenta thanks to the white balance, but now the flash looks too magenta. So what are we going to do? Well, we've got to make both light sources the same color. So rather than try to put daylight filters over all these fluorescent bulbs, it's easier to make our flash the same color as the fluorescent by adding a small filter, a green filter. So what I'm going to do is add this green gel filter to the front of the flash, and that will change the light balance of the flash unit from daylight to fluorescent. Now, let's take a shot and see what that does. Okay, here we go, Taylor. We're in the home stretch. Okay, and now we've got a beautifully lit environmental portrait, and that is what we call in the business a wrap. Taylor, thank you so much. It's been a pleasure working with you. Enjoy the rest of your day. Now let's take a look at how to work with Nikon's amazing Creative Lighting System, otherwise known as the CLS. And by the way, if you have any questions about the terminology we've been using, we've added a glossary of terms in your DVD package for your easy reference. The Nikon Creative Lighting System consists of the world's most intelligent and versatile, yet incredibly portable lighting tools that make flash control exceptionally intuitive. The system includes the innovative Nikon SB900 Speedlight, as well as the SB800, SB600, and SBR200 Speedlights. I'd like to show you how easy it is to set up and control Nikon Speedlights in a variety of multiple wireless flash situations. By using Nikon's advanced wireless lighting system, you can set up the SB900 as a master flash unit in the commander mode, which allows you to wirelessly control Nikon remote speedlight units in as many as three different remote groups. We're also going to show you how to set up the Nikon D300 digital SLR using the built-in flash as a wireless commander The steps are very similar to setting up cameras like the D700 and D80 that also have wireless commander control through the built-in flash. And the D3 with the SU800 wireless commander. And finally, we'll put together the R1C1 wireless close-up speedlight system, which is the perfect portable lighting system for indoor and outdoor close-up shooting, and comes supplied with the SU800 wireless commander. Let's start by setting up the SB900 Speedlight to be our master flash unit for wireless multiple flash photography in the commander mode. When the SB900 is in master mode, the other Speedlight units should be set to remote in order to fire wirelessly. The commander mode enables the SB900 to trigger remote Nikon Speedlight units. While in commander mode, the SB900 wirelessly controls as many as three remote groups of speedlights, A, B, and C. Once the remote speedlight units are placed within a scene, you can conveniently and easily control their output without moving from your shooting position. The Nikon Creative Lighting System offers four separate channels, allowing several photographers using Nikon CLS-enabled wireless speedlights to set a channel different from yours. This prevents unintentional triggering of other speedlights in the same setting, such as at a wedding, press conference, or sporting event. However, if you're like me and you typically shoot by yourself, it's a good idea to pick one channel that you always work with and set your master and remote speedlights to always work with that channel. The SB900 places the wireless master and remote command switches on the outside of the speedlight. While holding down the button in the center, align the index on the power on-off switch to the master setting. And that's it. It really doesn't get much easier or quicker than that. The SB900's LCD display will change to the master view, which includes the groups, channel options, and compensation values that you'll be working with. First, be sure to choose and set the channel that will be used to trigger your remote speedlights. Press Function button 2, just under the CH on the display, to highlight the channel. Turn the dial selector to choose the desired channel and press the OK button. My personal favorite, channel 3. Let's set the flash mode and flash output level compensation value for the master unit. This procedure applies to setting groups A, B, and C. To set the flash mode, press Function button 1 on the master flash unit to highlight M. Press the Mode button, turn the dial selector to choose the desired flash mode, and press the OK button. Your flash mode options include TTL, through the lens flash metering, A for auto aperture, M for manual output, and these dashes mean that you have no light output from the master unit or selected group, although even with the dashes, a pre-flash will occur. You can change the flash output compensation value for the M group, press Function button 2. Then turn the dial selector to choose the desired flash output level compensation value and press the OK button. Now, press Function button 1 to highlight the group A. Repeat these procedures to set the flash mode and flash output level compensation values of the remote flash units as we did with the M master speedlight. In the same way as with group A, set the flash mode and flash output level compensation values of the remote flash units in groups B and C. Now, if you want to make changes to the flash mode and power output of the remote speedlight units during shooting, you can do so from the master SB900. The change will take effect immediately. You know, one of the things I've learned to do is trust in Nikon speedlight technology. And you should do the same. Although there are times when I'll try different modes, I typically choose the TTL flash mode and simply adjust the output compensation, plus or minus, based on the conditions of the scene. Now let's set up the Nikon D300 digital SLR as our commander. The steps are very similar to setting up cameras like the D700 and D80 that also have wireless commander control through the built-in flash. First, we select the wireless flash commander mode option within the custom settings menu under the built-in flash option. On the D300, the custom setting is E3. When you enter the commander mode, the built-in flash, Group A and Group B are all activated and set to TTL with zero exposure compensation. In this scenario, the built-in flash will send a pre-flash signal to the remote speedlights with exposure and triggering information. You can adjust flash compensation for groups A and B, as well as the built-in flash. Press the camera's multi-selector right or left to move into the mode or compensation windows for the built-in flash and both groups. Use the up and down arrows with the multi-selector to set your desired values. You can set the built-in flash as well as the A and B groups to fire and be factored into the exposure. Or they can be turned off individually depending on your lighting requirements. Just toggle the multi-selector to the right to enter the mode window for the item you want to turn off. Toggle the multi-selector up or down until you see the dashed lines. This means that the built-in flash or selected speedlight will not fire. Keep in mind that although you may turn off the built-in flash from being calculated into the exposure, it will still send the pre-flash signal to control the remote units. This pre-flash communicates with the other speedlights and does not occur during the actual exposure. Once you've set the commander mode to your liking, be sure that the channel you've selected matches the channel set on the remote units. Also, be sure to press the OK button to confirm and set the commander mode. Another thing to note is that the wireless flash commander mode works only in program, shutter priority, aperture priority, or the manual exposure modes. Now the good news is you can use an unlimited number of remote units in each of the speedlight groups, which offers an incredible amount of creative lighting control. Now, we'll attach the SU800 to the Nikon D3 digital SLR and use it as our wireless speedlight commander. By the way, the SU800 works with all Nikon CLS-compatible digital SLR cameras, whether or not they have a built-in flash commander. In this configuration, the remote flash units can be divided into three groups, A, B, and C, and the flash output level can be separately set for each group of master and remote flash units. First, let's use the Commander Close-Up Select switch, found in the battery chamber area, to select the commander function that allows for three-group remote operation. Then, turn on the D3 and SU800. Make sure that the ready light on the SU800 comes on. Now, we can set the remote flash unit's flash mode. Press the Select Function button to display the flash mode, which is blinking for each group. The options for flash mode of our remote flash units include TTL, AA, M, or flash canceled. TTL is recommended for normal flash shooting. Select the group name, A, B, or C. Press the arrow buttons, left or right, to change the flash output level compensation value in TTL and AA modes. Select the manual flash output in the M mode. Set the channel 1, 2, 3, or 4 by pressing the Select Function button to display the number, which is blinking. Press the arrow buttons, left or right, to change the channel number. Press the Select Function button again, and the channel number will stop blinking. The last channel number to blink is the one that has been automatically set. With advanced wireless lighting, you can operate multiple wireless remote Speedlight units in the TTL, AA, or manual mode. You can divide the remote flash units into three groups and control the flash output independently for each group, expanding your range of creative multiple flash shooting techniques. Let's start by setting up the SB900 Speedlight as the remote Speedlight unit. Right here on the SB900, we're going to align the index on the power on-off switch to remote. Now, we'll assign group names and channel numbers on the remote flash units. First, press function button 1. Then turn the dial selector to choose a desired group name and press the OK button. The group name and channel number being set appears larger. For remote flash units, the SB900 in commander mode must be able to set the flash mode and flash output level compensation values of the remote units. So make sure to set the remote flash units into the same group as selected on the master unit. I'll press function button 2, then turn the dial selector to the desired channel number and press the OK button. Finally, we need to make sure to choose the same channel number as set on the master flash unit. Okay, now let's set up the SB800 Speedlight as a wireless remote Speedlight unit. With the SB800 on, press and hold the select button for 2 seconds. Locate the shaded box and use the multi-selector to toggle and highlight the wireless symbol. Press select for 1 second. Scroll down and select remote by highlighting it and pressing select for 2 seconds. The display will change to the remote view. Press select to highlight channel and use the plus minus button to select the correct channel. Be sure to set the remote and master units to the same channel. And finally, press select again to highlight the group. Use the plus minus button to choose group A, B, or C. The amount of output compensation set for groups A, B, and C on the master flash will determine the amount of output from the remote speed lights. Keep in mind that when placing any of the remote speed lights into position, the light sensor on the remote unit needs to see the pre-flash light directly or bounce from the master speed light unit. To exit wireless and return to normal TTL operation, just reset the SB800 to normal TTL operation by holding the on-off and mode button for 2 seconds. When you're done, just reset all units back to their original status. Now, we'll set up the SB600 Speedlight as a wireless remote unit. With the SB600 on, press and hold the zoom and the dash symbol together for 2 seconds. Press either the zoom or mode button to select wireless mode on or off. Set it to on. Press on off once. The flash will be set in the wireless remote mode. The default setting is channel 3, group A. Press mode to highlight the channel and select 1, 2, 3, or 4 using the plus minus button. Be sure to select the same channel as the master flash. Press mode again and assign a group A, B, or C for this remote speed light. The amount of output compensation set for that group on the master flash will determine the amount of output from the remote speed light group. The SBR200 is another handy little Nikon Speedlight to add to the mix of remote units. It offers a lot of creative options for close-up lighting as part of Nikon's wireless close-up Speedlight system. It can also fit perfectly into any multiple lighting situation to selectively add a splash of light to an area or a scene. It can be held in your hand, or it can be freely positioned using the AS20 Speedlight stand. To set up the remote flash, press the on-off button to turn on the SBR200. set the channel by rotating the channel select dial to the desired channel. Be sure to set the same channel number as set on the wireless commander. To assign the remote flash units to a group, rotate the group select dial. Once set, the SBR200 operates according to the controls set on the commander. The Nikon Creative Lighting System consists of the world's most intelligent, versatile, and yet incredibly portable lighting tools that make your flash control exceptionally intuitive. The system includes the groundbreaking Nikon SB800 Speedlight, the SB600, SBR200 Speedlights, and the SB900 Speedlight. Now, I often refer to the array of Nikon cords that help connect cameras and flash units. But today, we're talking about wireless operations, and I'm going to show you how easy it is to set up and control Nikon Speedlights in a variety of multiple wireless flash situations. By using Nikon's advanced wireless lighting system, you can set up the SB800 as a master flash unit in the commander mode. This allows you to wirelessly control your Nikon remote Speedlight units in as many as three different groups. We're also going to show you how to set up your Nikon D300 digital SLR using the built-in flash as a wireless commander. The steps are very similar to setting up cameras like the D700 and D80 that also have wireless commander control through the built-in flash, and the D3 with the SU800 wireless commander. And finally, we'll put together the R1C1 wireless close-up Speedlight system, which is the perfect portable lighting system for indoor and outdoor close-up shooting, and comes supplied with the SU800 wireless commander. First, we'll set up the SB800 to work as a master flash unit in the commander mode. While in commander mode, the SB800 wirelessly controls as many as three remote groups of speedlights, A, B, and C. Once your remote speedlight units are set up, you can conveniently and easily control their output without moving from your shooting position. Represented by M, the master flash on the camera can be set to output light within the scene or act solely as a trigger for the remote speedlights. The Nikon Creative Lighting System offers four separate channels, allowing several photographers using Nikon CLS-enabled wireless speedlights to set up a channel different from yours. This prevents unintentional triggering of the other speedlights in the same setting, such as at a wedding, press conference, or sporting event. However, if you're like me and you typically shoot by yourself, it's a good idea to pick one channel that you always work with and set your master and remote speedlights to always work with that channel. Now, before starting, we just need to make sure that the SB800 Speedlight is connected to the hot shoe of a Nikon ITTL compatible camera. And with that, we're ready to set up the master flash unit. First, with the unit turned on, press and hold the SEL select button for several seconds. You'll see the LCD display change. Then, locate the shaded box and use the multi-selector to toggle and highlight this wireless symbol. Next, press select for 1 second. The arrow symbol will change to two arrows, one up and one down, and the off selection on the right will become shaded. Scroll down and select master by highlighting it and pressing select for 2 seconds. Now you can also press the on-off button to quickly return to the main LCD view. The SB800's LCD display will change to the master view, which includes the groups, channel options, and compensation values that you'll be working with. Press select to highlight the M group. You can change the flash output compensation value for the M group by pressing the plus minus button. Pressing mode while group M, A, B, or C is highlighted will change how the speedlights in that group will react. Your flash mode options include TTL, for through-the-lens metering, A for auto aperture, M for manual output, and these dashes mean that you have no light output from the master unit or selected group, although even with dashes, a pre-flash will occur. Press select to jump from group M to A to B to C. You can set the amount of flash output compensation for each group by using the plus minus button as you go. Use select to highlight CH or channel, and use the plus minus to select the channel you'll be working in. Now keep in mind that the channel you choose for the master speedlight must be the same channel set on the remote. Now if you want to change the power output of the remote flash units during shooting, you can do so from the SB800 master flash. The change will take effect immediately. The SB800 speedlight acts as a commander unit when placed in master mode. For other speedlight units to fire wirelessly, they must be set to remote. Now let's set up the Nikon D300 digital SLR as our commander. The steps are very similar to setting up cameras like the D700 and D80 that also have wireless commander control through the built-in flash. First, we select the wireless flash commander mode option within the custom settings menu under the built-in flash option. On the D300, the custom setting is E3. When you enter the commander mode, the built-in flash, group A and group B are all activated and set to TTL with zero exposure compensation. In this scenario, the built-in flash will send a pre-flash signal to the remote speedlights with exposure and triggering information. You can adjust flash compensation for groups A and B, as well as the built-in flash. Press the camera's multi-selector right or left to move into the mode or compensation windows for the built-in flash and both groups. Use the up and down arrows with the multi-selector to set your desired values. You can set the built-in flash as well as the A and B groups to fire and be factored into the exposure. Or they can be turned off individually depending on your lighting requirements. Just toggle the multi-selector to the right to enter the mode window for the item you want to turn off. Toggle the multi-selector up or down until you see the dashed lines. This means that the built-in flash or selected speedlight will not fire. Keep in mind that although you may turn off the built-in flash from being calculated into the exposure, it will still send the pre-flash signal to control the remote units. This pre-flash communicates with the other speedlights and does not occur during the actual exposure. Once you've set the commander mode to your liking, be sure that the channel you've selected matches the channel set on the remote units. Also, be sure to press the OK button to confirm and set the commander mode. Another thing to note is that the wireless flash commander mode works only in program, shutter priority, aperture priority, or the manual exposure modes. Now the good news is you can use an unlimited number of remote units in each of the speedlight groups, which offers an incredible amount of creative lighting control. Now, we'll attach the SU800 to the Nikon D3 digital SLR and use it as our wireless speedlight commander. By the way, the SU800 works with all Nikon CLS compatible digital SLR cameras, whether or not they have a built-in flash commander. In this configuration, the remote flash units can be divided into three groups, A, B, and C. And the flash output level can be separately set for each group of master and remote flash units. First, let's use the commander close-up select switch, found in the battery chamber area, to select the commander function that allows for three-group remote operation. Then, turn on the D3 and SU800. Make sure that the ready light on the SU800 comes on. Now, we can set the remote flash unit's flash mode. press the select function button to display the flash mode, which is blinking for each group. The options for flash mode of our remote flash units include TTL, AA, M, or flash canceled. TTL is recommended for normal flash shooting. Select the group name A, B, or C. Press the arrow buttons, left or right, to change the flash output level compensation value in TTL and AA modes. Select the manual flash output in the M mode. Set the channel 1, 2, 3, or 4 by pressing the select function button to display the number, which is blinking. Press the arrow buttons, left or right, to change the channel number. Press the select function button again, and the channel number will stop blinking. The last channel number to blink is the one that has been automatically set. With advanced wireless lighting, you can operate multiple wireless remote speedlight units in the TTL mode. You can divide the remote flash units in this mode into three groups and control the flash output independently for each group, expanding your range of creative multiple flash shooting techniques. Let's start by setting up the SB800 Speedlight as a wireless remote speedlight unit. With the SB800 on, press and hold the select button for 2 seconds. Locate the shaded box and use the multi-selector to toggle and highlight the wireless symbol. Press select for 1 second. The arrow symbol will change to 2 arrows, one up and one down. Scroll down and select remote by highlighting it and pressing select for 2 seconds. The display will change to the remote view. Press select to highlight channel and use the plus minus button to select the correct channel. Be sure to set the remote and master units to the same channel. And finally, press select again to highlight the group. Use the plus minus button to choose group A, B, or C. The amount of output compensation set for groups A, B, and C on the master flash will determine the amount of output from the remote speedlights. Keep in mind that when placing any of the remote speedlights into position, the light sensor on the remote unit needs to see the pre-flash light directly or bounce from the master speedlight unit. To exit wireless and return to normal TTL operation, just reset the SB800 to normal TTL operation by holding the on, off, and mode button for 2 seconds. When you're done, just reset all units back to their original status. Now, we'll set up the SB600 Speedlight as a wireless remote unit. With the SB600 on, press and hold the zoom and the dash symbol together for 2 seconds. Press either the zoom or mode button to select wireless mode on or off. Set it to on. Press on off once. The flash will be set in the wireless remote mode. The default setting is channel 3, group A. Press mode to highlight the channel and select 1, 2, 3, or 4 using the plus minus button. Be sure to select the same channel as the master flash. Press mode again and assign a group A, B, or C for this remote speedlight. The amount of output compensation set for that group on the master flash will determine the amount of output from the remote speedlight group. The SBR200 is another handy little Nikon speedlight to add to the mix of remote units. It offers a lot of creative options for close-up lighting as part of Nikon's wireless close-up speedlight system. It can also fit perfectly into any multiple lighting situation to selectively add a splash of light to an area or a scene. It can be held in your hand, or it can be freely positioned using the AS20 Speedlight stand. To set up the remote flash, press the on-off button to turn on the SBR 200. Set the channel by rotating the channel select dial to the desired channel. Be sure to set the same channel number as set on the wireless commander. To assign the remote flash units to a group, rotate the group select dial. Once set, the SBR 200 operates according to the controls set on the commander. Finally, let's set up the SB900 Speedlight as the remote flash unit. Right here on the SB900, we're going to simply align the index on the power on-off switch wireless setting to remote. Now, we'll assign a group and channel for the remote unit. First, press function button 1. Then, turn the dial selector to choose a desired group name, and press the OK button. The group name and channel number being set appear larger. I'll press function button 2, turn the dial selector to select the desired channel number, and press the OK button. Finally, we need to be sure to choose the same channel number as set on the master flash unit. The Nikon Creative Lighting System offers us a range of simple automated tools for lighting our close-up photographs. The R1C1 Wireless Close-Up Speedlight System includes the SU800 Wireless Speedlight Commander, two SBR200 Wireless Remote Speedlights, and a host of other accessories that allow for working efficiently and creatively with flowers, watches, and other small objects. Now the SBR200 attaches to the front of the lens with the XS1 attachment ring. Now you can attach up to 4 of these units on the ring mounted on the front of your lens. You can also mount up to 8 units on the XS1 mounted on a light stand or tripod for an incredible circular light pattern around the ring. Used independently, the unit can be freely mounted on the AS20 stand for easy placement in any scene. In the commander mode, the SU800 wireless commander unit attaches to the hot shoe on the camera and coordinates the independent wireless operation of two groups, A and B, of SBR200s in the close-up mode, or three groups, A, B, and C, of compatible speedlights in commander mode. Now let's take a look at all these great tools for close-up lighting. Filters, holders, attachment rings for your different lenses, and so much more. You can even have a translucent diffuser panel with a flexible arm for even greater creative lighting control. And there you have it, a fully automated and independent wireless flash system for an unlimited combination of remote flash units to meet your photographic vision. Now keep in mind that if you have a Nikon camera with a built-in flash that acts as a wireless commander, the R1 outfit without the SU800 commander is also available. Both close-up speedlight outfits work with all other components of the CLS speedlight system, including the SB600. So let's see how it all works and take a picture. Okay, here's our basic close-up setup. I've got this lovely chrome pocket watch that I'd like to make a dramatic photograph to put on an online auction site. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start with basically the same kind of setup that we used with our model tail art yesterday. I'm going to start with one diffuse side light. Now I'm using the diffusion sheet and the alligator clamp and arm that's included in the kit, and I've got one of the flash units right behind here. Now the reason I'm doing this is because I'm creating a larger light source than the actual size of the subject, so it's going to be a very soft but directional light, but the quality is going to be very diffused. Now I know from experience that when you're shooting chrome, you want to have a lot of fill cards for those nice white highlights, those nice reflected highlights. So I've taken some foam core that I've gotten from a stationery store and I've made a little fill card here. Now that's going to fill the side here. I've got white on the bottom, and now I'm going to complete the illusion here by actually putting a white top on it. So what I've done is created kind of a light tent around this, so that's going to give me this beautiful soft wrap with lots of open highlights. And I've got the SU-800 wireless commander here. We're just going to use one diffuse side light, and I'm going to use a black background. I'm going to use the bottom of the case here. You have to improvise when you're doing close-up photography, because I think that chrome is really going to stand out nicely against the black. So let's take our first exposure and see what we get. All right. Now you can see it's a beautiful shot. We get a lot of nice fill and everything on the shadow side because of the cards. The black looks great, pretty dramatic, but you know, I want to try a little variation here. There may be a little too much contrast between the black background and the bright chrome watch. So I'm going to take a piece of white foam core and I'm going to stick it right there as my backdrop. Now I'm going to take a second frame, and you're going to be interested to see what happens here. What happened to the white background? It looks gray, doesn't it? Well, remember what we said about flash falling off quickly. That's quite a distance between our main light and the background light. It's receiving a lot less light than our main subject, and it's fallen off, and it's rendered it as a nice mid-tone gray. Now, it looks great, but it's not white. It looks really good, but that's what happens when we say that flash falls off quickly. I'm not kidding. You see, it's about a foot here, and it's fallen off, but it gives us a nice gray background. But you know, you got to compete against a lot of things on these online sites, so I want to jazz it up a little. So I think I'm going to try to add a second light, maybe light the background a color, by adding a red gel onto the second unit, and I'm going to throw that light on the background. And we've got the bright red there. That's going to look good. I'm just going to hide that behind the watch and aim it up towards the background. Okay, let's see what happens. Okay, you see what that red does in the background. Not only does it create a beautiful wash of color, but now we can see through the watch parts. One of the selling points of this watch is that it has an open movement in the back and the front. And the red allows that to show through a little more than the gray or the black. So the red not only adds color, but it lets us see detail. Now I am using an F11 here to get sufficient depth of field, because you know when you're shooting macro, you need as much depth of field as you possibly can get. F11 seems to do the job. It gives me nice, sharp front-to-back focus on the watch, but it doesn't focus too much on the background. So now, it's just a matter of, you know, a little variety. So I'm gonna see, now that I know that the color on the background works well, I'm gonna try a different color and see what happens. The red is a hot color, blue has more of a cool feel. Let's see what happens there. Okay. Now, I'm controlling the output of each flash using the A and B channel on the SU-800, so I can vary the power if I need to, but these gels seem to be about the same, so I'm going to start with the same settings. And let's see what happens when we do the blue. Okay, another nice rendition. Much cooler this time, but now we can still see through the watch, and now we have this blue wash behind it. So now, using these simple two strobes, I've done four different setups and created a shot that I think is going to sell this watch really fast. What we have in the Nikon Creative Lighting System is a compact, portable set of lights. But compact lights are no good at all if you don't have something compact to work with. And the problem with a lot of studio equipment, light stands, umbrellas, and the like, is that they are built for the studio, and it's a little hard to move them around. Now, most of what I do is location and travel photography, so I found lightweight, small, collapsible components that do the same job. And I'd like to share some of that with you now. All my gear for my little portable studio fits in this carry-on case. Let's take a look at the heart of it. To start with, I've got three Speedlights, two SB900s and an 800. Now you notice, I keep them in the cases just for extra protection, but I've got them pre-mounted on these little umbrella brackets. Now let's take a look. Why do I do that? Well, it's faster. I don't have to set them up each time I want to put them on a light. First, I've got the cold shoe where the flash is mounted. Why is it called a cold shoe? Well, it has no contacts. It's just a flash holder. Then I've got it on a small ball head here, and that's mounted to this umbrella bracket. Now, I do the ball head because it's easy for me to get the flash right along the axis of the umbrella like that, and it's very convenient. So here we have the three speed lights. Now, to hold them, I've got three compact light stands. Look how small these collapse down, but they open up to about 6.5 feet, which is high enough for most of what I need to do. So here I've got three of these, studio in a box right here. I've got a 32-inch reflector with five surfaces. It can be white, translucent, silver, gold, or a mix of silver and gold. Now I'm interested in diffusing my light sources, besides the reflector, I've also got two umbrellas. Now look how compactly these fold down, about 15 inches, but when they open up, they're about a 39-inch diameter umbrella, but they both fit in there just like that. Now, there are times when I don't want to diffuse the light, I want to concentrate the light. I want to focus that beam down. For that, I'm going to be carrying a pair of grid spots, and you can see they have different diameters in there for focusing the light tighter or a little looser, and they Velcro right onto the outside of the flash. And then I also have some snoots. Now a snoot wraps around and forms like a tube, wraps around the front of the light, forms a tube that restricts the flow of light as well. So I've got diffusers and concentrators, just light modifiers, very small and very compact. Now sometimes I have to shoot all day long with flash, and for those instances, I have these extra battery packs, the SD9 and the SD8A. Now I often shoot with two camera bodies, one with a wide angle zoom and one with a telephoto zoom. So for that, I carry not one, but two of these SU-800 wireless commander units. That way I can seamlessly go from one camera body to the other and have my setup be controlled wirelessly. And finally, for those times where you just can't have a light stand in the picture, I carry just a little alligator clamp with a ball head and another cold shoe on, so I can clamp a unit onto a ceiling panel or a bookcase, the top of a door, anything like that. I've got my trusty roll of gaffer's tape. Now gaffer's tape, it's like duct tape, only the adhesive is a little more forgiving to walls and everything. Every photographer loves his gaffer's tape. You can get it at any camera store or lighting outlet. And then I've just got some extra colored gels, some extra batteries for my controllers, as well as extra batteries for the units themselves, and a few extra alligator clamps in here. And there you have it, a studio in a case. It fits in any airline's carry-on bin, so I can roll this on and roll my camera bag on and be ready for any assignment with just carry-on. Now that we know the what and the why of using speed lights, let's take a look at how with my good friend and colleague Joe McNally as he works out in the field. Now Joe is one of the most published photographers working today. His work has graced the covers of major publications from Sports Illustrated to National Geographic, and all kinds of commercial assignments from FedEx to Target. He frequently lectures and conducts workshops on lighting all around the world. We're going to join Joe on three locations: the Boston Ballet School, at a bride's home before her wedding, and cruising the Gloucester Harbor. We've picked these locations to illustrate that you don't have to fly halfway around the world to take great pictures. In fact, opportunities are right there in your own neighborhood, and all you need to do is seek them out. So let's go catch up with Joe over at the Boston Ballet School. We're here at the Boston Ballet School, which is the largest ballet school in North America, with over 3,000 students a year. Now the kind of techniques Joe will be employing today are the same kind of things we did back in the studio. We'll be talking about sync speeds, normal sync, slow sync, and auto FP high speed sync. We'll be talking about modifying the light, bouncing it, concentrating it, and using it in different ways. Now Joe will be doing all of this using Nikon's CLS wireless flash system. And we'll always keep in mind the direction, the quality, and the color of the light.
Let me make a couple introductions here. This is Samantha. She's from Bismarck, North Dakota. And this is Hannah, who's from New Zealand.
Well, thanks for helping us out today, girls. Joe, when you come into a situation like this, what is the first thing that you do?
Just what I mentioned, the introductions. I introduce myself, I try to get to know my subjects a little bit. The second step would be location assessment.
Okay, and that means what? Taking a look at the light, the bounce surfaces, that kind of thing?
Sure. In this situation, we've got some sunlight coming through the windows, but we also have windows over here, so we have a basically good quality of light, but we're definitely going to have to tweak that with some fill flash, especially when I start to do a portrait of you guys.
What equipment are we starting out with today?
I got a D300 and the 16-85, which is a very sharp lens. It's a wonderful lens that can give me the environment, but also come in tight for a portrait.
Great, great. Well, let's get started.
All right, sounds good. I'm going to start maybe Samantha first, and I'm going to ask you to step over here if you wouldn't mind. Remember we were talking earlier, you had a wonderful sort of position. It was down on the floor when you were in the middle of stretching. Why don't we start there? Okay. That looks great. Absolutely terrific. Perfect. Okay, let's shoot a couple here. Okay. All right. Bob, if you can see what I'm doing here. As you can see, Samantha's got this amazing athletic pose,
yeah,
and at the same time, she's very graceful. Her eyes are, you know, she's got eye contact with the camera. But as you can see, away from that light coming through the window, it's contrasty, and her face is dark. So the very first thing I'm going to do is bring in a little fill flash. As you know, I know we've been doing this a long time. What's one of the first things you try to do anyway is see if you can redirect the light, get it off the camera, if you can.
Exactly.
You know, that's a good strategy.
Yeah.
So for that, the system makes it easy to move a light off the camera. I'm going to pop up my commander strobe. Now, this built-in here is going to drive a remote flash. We're going to program that into a group and a channel. In this instance, it's going to be channel 1, group A. And I'm going to bring in the SB900. And we'll bring it from this side because, you know, Samantha's direction and her whole body posture is coming from this way. So I'm going to push the light this way.
I'll grab an SB900.
All right, thanks. Sam, that's great position. What we're going to do is bring a light in here to fill the shadow side of your face.
Got the SB900 set up for remote, and we're going to make sure that sensor is aimed right towards you.
Okay, so group A, channel 1, here we go. Okay, now the audible signal that's giving me, it tells me via a series of beeps that, yes, I saw the signal, and yes, now I'm recycled. So that's a very handy thing when you're on location. All right, so as you can see, huge change.
Wow.
Okay, just beautiful light. And the amazing thing for me as a photographer is that I did that so simply. Let's try a couple more, okay? And let's emphasize for a minute here how quickly that thing recycles. I'm just gonna go through a whole bunch of exposures really quickly here, okay, Sam? So you just kind of relax, look at camera, and just vary your facial expression, smiles, okay? Here we go. All right, perfect. That's great, perfect, very nice. Okay, the zoom on the lens enables me to get different perspectives from this 16-85 without moving my perspective or moving myself around, perfect. Way to go, way to go. Okay, I'm gonna go vertical.
Now, Joe, we've got the light coming in from a 3/4 angle.
Yep.
Which provides a nice wraparound.
Well, let's take a look and see how we're doing.
Now, you're using normal sync on this.
Yeah, this is a straight up normal situation. I don't have a lot of stress. The subject is not moving. I'm not trying to chase them in any way. So it's a static portrait. So normal sync is perfectly fine for this type of thing. Now, also, when I looked at that, and you know, the value of that, this huge LCD back here gives me that detail, the eyes are looking a little down. So I'm gonna get a little bit of low.
Fill.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. Could All you right. grab that for
yeah,
me?
Sure, sure. Yeah.
All right, so, okay. All right, Sam, here we go. I think we're dialed in pretty well. I'm gonna come in close. You just keep coming at me with your eyes. Move your expression, here we go. Okay, perfect. Very nice, okay. That's great, perfect. Very sweet expression. Awesome. Why don't we stand up for a second? Bob, could you grab that fill card?
Absolutely.
You know, nice thing about this is we can change on the fly. Let's move back a little bit and let me pick up a little light in here. Okay, so this is gonna be a bit of a different exposure. Okay, let's spin even more into the light just a little bit. Okay, very nice, good. Working very close to my fill source here. Good, beautiful. Light, I think, there is a little bit strong. So what I can do here, let's just take a stop back out of it and see how we do.
Okay.
All right, follow me with your eyes there, Sam. That's great, looking good. Perfect. And you can drop your hands now and just do a classic dancer expression right at me. Okay, now I'm gonna reorient vertically. Beautiful, right there. I'm still in normal sync. Okay. All right, good, strong portrait solution, side light. But if you notice, that main light's a little poppy, a little mm-hmm. hard, okay? We've got the diffuser on, but I think the next step for us here is to go to an umbrella. Bob's gone to get an umbrella. I'd be lost without him. All right, here we go. Great. Perfect. Hey, Bob, while I'm shooting this, would you mind going to get that gold reflector for me, that gold flex fill? Yeah, great smile. Let's just quickly bring some in here, and let's see what happens. You know, light picks up the color of whatever it hits. So let's see if we can introduce a little warm highlight on that far side of the light. Here we go, right at me. So let's take a look. Okay, what we've got here now is with that gold flex fill, there's a little shimmer mm-hmm. of warm light, and that's the pickup from the gold side. Nice warmth in a portrait, as you know, goes a long way. So let's keep going here. The wonderful thing about the LCD, how bright, how clear it is, and also we can magnify.
Zoom in. You know, is that sharp? Look at that.
We can just take a look at every aspect of the picture via the zoom, and you can see the section of the face and the piece of the puzzle there that you're looking at.
This is very similar to the setup that we were using in the studio, and I think the good thing to know about this is that these basic kind of setups are applicable anywhere, you know, in the studio, on location, wherever you go.
The umbrella is a basic tool. How long does it take us to set this up?
30 seconds.
Yeah. Very nice. Very nice. Okay, stick with me now. Perfect. Thank you so much. All right, so we were at an umbrella there. Very simple portrait headshot, okay? Hey, Hannah, how you doing?
Hi.
Would you mind standing for us? Thanks for working with us today.
Hi.
Appreciate it. Let's try it with a standing portrait where we get a lot of environment. In the other situation, we really had no environment. It was just all about the portrait. But here, we're going to be dealing with a lot of different elements. We've got the window light, a bit of interior light, and if I just go and walk up to Hannah and make a picture, you know what's going to happen, right?
Silhouette City.
Silhouette City.
It's
here we go.
Light. The direction is from the back.
All right. So let's just take a look here. So the camera is going to make, you know, a very smart decision here, basically. It is parsing out for me exactly what it's seeing. So it's not making a mistake. But you have to think like your digital camera. What's the camera reacting to?
The brightest part of the light.
Right. So when I'm going to try to work this just via metering with no light at all, one thing you say, well, if I wanted to get detail, and Hannah, let's go to a spot meter mode and come right off of her skin tone that's on the shadow side.
Of course, then you lose the highlights or the highlights burn out behind her.
Let's take a look. Whoa.
Yeah, now she's properly exposed, but the windows are burned out.
Exactly, exactly. What's the answer there?
Fill light, exactly. Okay.
All right, Hannah, you're being very patient with all this, so I ask you to just stand, maybe move a little bit closer to camera. All right, here we go. Hannah, you look fantastic. So, here we go. Simple, easy. Let's see how we do. Fast difference, right?
Yeah. So, that speed light, that makes a huge difference.
I mean, one speed light makes a makes this a photograph as opposed to something that was, you know, just never going to work. So what we're doing here within the dynamic range of the camera, we're applying some light in this direction. And the camera's doing so many things for us, okay? You've got the camera meter picking up all of this as well as the exterior exposure. The lens is giving us distance information. The flash is metering. All of those elements are combining in milliseconds to make this, you know, exposure that I don't even have to do anything to.
Yeah.
Hannah, if you could remember that position, in fact, even just hold it. Bob, let's quickly reorient the light to emphasize her body position, and let's take it over here.
Yeah, I was thinking
okay.
that a little more.
And if we get a little bit of drama out of this, I think we're just really gonna cook.
Yeah.
Always remember, and I know you do, shadows are your friend, you know?
When they're in the right place.
Exactly. Let's see if we can, I'm gonna go over by Hannah, because again, what I do when I change a light, I get my subject's position. Let's scoot it this way, and now let's feather back. Okay, there we go, right about there. Okay. Hannah, again, key that way. Perfect. Let's take a look.
Wow.
So, pretty dramatic,
yes.
Angular sort of picture now, okay?
Because the light has come from a three-quarter to almost a three-quarter from behind. It's really beautiful.
So now I'm going to, a couple of things. I made a wide scene. I've got a little bit of reflection over here. I'm going to move the angle a little bit tighter. And I think I'm going to put a little more power into that strobe, too.
Okay.
So I'm going to put up let's say one stop into the Speedlight.
Okay.
Okay, crop in a little tighter, and here we go. Hannah, again, key that way. Perfect. Gonna reorient vertically for her position now. Let's see how we do.
Wow,
okay.
That is gorgeous.
Down a little bit, if you don't mind, Hannah. That's it, great. Good, good, right there, hold. Beautiful, perfect, wonderful.
Joe, we've got a couple of the young ballerinas in those lovely tutus here. We've got that big window with the lovely ambient light out there. What's your thinking on this next shot coming up?
Well, I'm going to use both those elements, put them together into a frame. The window has beautiful color outside. It also helps me in terms of frame, you know, for those two dancers. And what we're going to do is take their tutus, which have beautiful color and transmit light really well, and backlight them. So what we'll do is we'll put some snoots on those lights that are already zoomed. So we're going to have a pretty tight pool of light coming out of those and hit the dresses. The effect should be hard when it hits the dress, but then it'll translate softly through all that color fabric. The way we're treating this lighting scenario is the backlight is really the main light.
Right.
So this frontal light is fill, so I'm going to treat that very gently. Push a little light through a soft umbrella that's overhead and bounce a little light off the floor, but control it really, really carefully so it doesn't overpower the main effect I'm trying to achieve, which is to get the color of those dance costumes.
Right, right. So the fill light is going to be diffused, the main lights are going to be specular, and it should look great.
So what I'm going to do here is make sure that my B group is running. I've got zero compensation dialed into the B group. The A group is directing those background SB900s, and that I'm really playing with because I need a lot of power on those lights to just push through that fabric.
Yeah.
So let's see how we do here. Ladies, position, wonderful. Okay, that's absolutely terrific. Okay, now, there's such a strong light that's coming from the background.
A little more fill?
I need a little more fill from that B group. Yeah. So. Again, instantly and wirelessly, I'm going to go into the menu. I'm going to take that B group speed light, which is shooting through the umbrella, which is an SB800. I'm going to pop it up. Let's say plus one. Hit OK and see if we get a little more light out of that. Beautiful. OK.
There you go. Yeah.
All right.
Boy, the 800s and the 900s work seamlessly together.
They do. They're the same operating system, if you will, to borrow a computer term. Okay, I've created a bit of a problem for myself that I'm going to have to solve, and that's I've got the reflected umbrella in the window. So I'm going to have to push that back a little bit and perhaps flag it, a term we use called flagging to make sure
exactly.
You know, that it's not in the window.
Why don't you let me do that for you?
Go ahead, Bob. I'll wait.
How's the flag position, Joe?
Let's just check that out here. Good. Pretty. A little shimmer up there, but it's starting to work. I think there's another thing that we could do here. A small little kicker light from down below could really inform this pretty well.
Yeah.
So why don't we try another light source?
Okay.
And I think for this one, we could use probably an SB600.
Okay.
Yeah, let's try that. Good, right there, hold. Beautiful, stay with me. Beautiful. Lovely. That's it. One more, stay there, up. Beautiful, relax, ladies. Awesome. Okay, you know, you guys are great. I think we're done. Fantastic, bravo.
Joe, one of the classic shots that we always face is the group shot. You know, whether it's a Little League team, a wedding group, or even a group of young ballerinas, it always presents a lighting challenge. So what are some of your tips for handling that?
First off, don't do it ever. No, kidding. Of course, group pictures come with the turf. And the very first thing you have to do with a group is just establish your presence with them. Even if it's only for a few seconds, get to know them a little bit. A little bit of banter, again, as we were talking about before, makes smooth the road. And then, of course, the issue is the wideness of the group. How do you get light all the way around this group, edge to edge. And the SB900 has a couple of features that will help you out. Illumination patterns is what they're calling them, where you can actually program into the SB900 a dispersion of light that's either center, standard, or even.
Well, I see we have our subjects in place. I'm going to let you go to work.
Okay. Let's come on down this way just a little bit. And I'm going to ask you to come on out just a little bit there. Okay, Kathy and Effie, come out this way, just a hair. Okay, we're going to put you more in a bit of a line there. You guys are going to look at me, and we're going to smile, okay? Count of three, ready?
One, two, three. Pretty terrific. One, two, three. Okay, now you guys keep looking at the camera, okay? Keep looking right here. Okay, fantastic. Oh, excuse me, I think I have to sneeze.
I'm gonna keep taking pictures as long as you guys keep giggling. Okay, relax, ladies. Stay with me for just a minute or two, okay? Now, Bob.
Yes, sir.
We got a couple of things going on here. What I've done here is I've programmed in a shutter speed that's picking up some of the ambient light behind me.
Slow sync flash.
Exactly. So even though I've got a flash on the camera, which classically might not be the ideal way to go. It's certainly possible. But if I've got even illumination programmed into this and blending some ambient light exposure, take a look.
It doesn't look like straight
flash at all.
It's not that classic, you know, black background with the harsh light coming from the front. It blends beautifully,
you know?
And all done automatically by the camera and the flash talking to each other. What's the next step?
Why don't we do the light off the camera?
Okay.
Okay, again, we'll follow our own advice. Let's pull the light off the camera. I'll go back to a commander up in here. I'm gonna ask you to hold the off-camera light.
Voice-actuated light stand.
There you go.
All right, I'll put that into remote.
Program remote, and I'm gonna double-check my menu.
I'm 1A.
All right, here we go. You ready? Fantastic. What's good smiles? Oh my goodness, ladies, that's fantastic. That's fantastic. Let's take a closer, let's focus in a little bit here. Magnify that image.
The light is even, it's perfectly spread across the group. Everybody looks good, and the blend of available light and flash is perfect there.
It is. You even got, the camera's even reading so much available light, you know, that we have a completely even illumination on the back walls and even some translation through that frosted glass. Pretty amazing.
Hey Joe, another way to get a nice even spread of light is adding a second one.
Yeah, two lights. In this instance, we're going to go with two SB800s. Ladies, are you ready to do this again?
Yeah.
One more time. All right. We're going to go three pictures, fantastic giggles. Okay, ready? One, two, three. Way to go. Irina, I'm looking at you. Good. I know you can do it. I know you can do it. Fantastic. You guys are great. Hang in there for me for one more minute. Now what, you know, what happened here is we have just a really smooth, you know, process of the light across the whole scene. The camera is dragging shutter, that term that we use.
Slow sync.
Slow sync. It's pulling in some ambient exposure. And you know what also, you know, I oftentimes feel if you go to a two light solution, your recycle, you know, is...
It's shorter, right.
Right there with you.
Yeah.
All right, this is the way we're going to do this. Everybody see me all right? Oh, okay, all right, I guess I'll have to adjust this, huh? Now, what we're doing up here is just doing a light panel. Now, you know, a little bit more sophisticated. Obviously, a little bit more work. But as you can see, it goes up pretty simply. All right, okay, ladies, here we go again. Positions, please. My goodness. All right, now I'm going to do a quick test picture here because we put up this newfangled light source, and we want to see how we're doing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Very smooth. Very smooth.
Silky light quality now.
You know what the amazing thing is? All the exposure information is originating at the point of view of the camera. And hence, I can put these lights behind something. Okay? Like this light panel. Have you noticed? I've touched none of the camera
controls. Yeah, it compensates automatically.
You know?
ITTL.
ITTL. I'm still in the same exposure I was when I didn't have this up.
Yeah.
Which is amazing. Okay. But not, again, not as amazing as you guys. Hey, Bob, I'm going to start to shoot a couple pictures, but could you get that low fill card for me again?
A low fill.
Ready? Dance positions, everyone. Last time. Okay, 159 and 47 seconds. I've got 12 seconds left. Bob, count it down. Let me see how many pictures
10,
I can make. Oh, no.
Nine.
Here we go.
Eight.
Right this way.
Seven.
Giggles.
Six.
More giggles.
Five.
One, two, three, there we go, there we go. All right, fantastic. Way to go. So I would be looking for peak activity somewhere in the neighborhood where Melanie is. And perhaps we can rotate through there. Maybe we can take turns. Each of you do your own particular expressive move and or you know, bring to the party that your own persona as a dancer. No, she's got to jump toward the light.
Okay, Joe, in this next scenario, we have some dancers who are going to go through some jumps and leaps for you. What's your ideas on handling motion with the Speedlights?
A couple of different ways to go about showing motion when you're photographing with a still camera. One would be to go with the flow, show the motion, let the action blur.
Now, to show the blur with a Speedlight, you'd be going to what, slow sync flash?
Slow sync is a very useful tool for that. You've got the stopping power of the flash, but you're blending that with the ambient light condition and a slow sync that retains some sharpness, but also shows that blur, that dynamic action that the dancer leaping through the air is bringing to the party here.
That's better.
Okay, and go. Beautiful. Okay, and again, please.
What do you think of this? For right now, what we're trying to do is see how well the flash will interact with the environment so that we have a bit of environment and we have some stopping power, but also the sense of motion in the dancer.
Yeah. So it's the shutter speed, the slower shutter speed, that's allowing for that slight blur, and the flash coming from the hard side direction is causing that nice crisp light that freezes her. But the direction of the light works beautifully. You've got a specular light source coming in from the side. There's shadows, but they're very beautifully placed, and it really works. Really works great with her jumping into the light. Joe, I think the amazing thing is when we look at this beautiful photograph that it's a result of only one Speedlight. And again, it's a sample of slow sync flash. Now, are you doing second curtain here?
I'm just going into second curtain now. Let's see what happens there.
All right, great. And we can talk a little about that.
All righty. All right, ready to go, Jackie? Same thing. I'm really liking the leading lines. I'm panning along with you and trying to get some motion out of your jump. So height and motion is where I'm going here. Okay? Okay, so what do we think of this?
Works great. I think the second curtain sync puts that blur behind it, and then, you know, the flash going off just before the shutters close really works for this motion.
When you're using front curtain sync, the flash goes off at the beginning of the exposure. Rear curtain sync goes off just before the shutter closes. When you're doing motion, it's more logical to go rear curtain because then the blur is behind the subject,
exactly,
and then the flash freezes.
Yeah, so you know the direction that the subject is going.
Mm-hmm. You know what I'm going to do now is I'm going to change things up a couple of ways. And how about we play with some color temperature and see how we do.
Great.
Okay.
So you're going to change your white balance.
I am. What I'm doing here is I'm taking that tungsten conversion filter, putting it on the strobe. That's keeping her warm, you know, and normally balanced. But then I shifted the camera,
white balance.
Of the overall, you know, what the camera's seeing in the overall scene to a tungsten.
Ah, so then the background's gonna go rich blue.
Exactly.
And she's gonna stay nice and warm.
Yeah.
What's it look like?
Plus, we've got motion.
Whoa.
You know, which is actually quite beautiful. I think it's very, you know, and very important for us as photographers to experiment. Experiment with color, with light, exposure, all of that stuff. I saw the pink tutu. And I thought, geez, you know, if that melded a little bit into a bluish environment, it could get very romantic, you know,
because it does look almost like stage lighting now. It's so dramatic and so moody with that blue background.
So let's take a look and see if we're sharp. That's always a crucial question.
Wow.
We are.
Yeah.
There's always that sharp and sharp enough. you know?
Yeah.
And the rear curtain helps us because what she's doing is flying and blurring, and then the flash fires at a much higher speed than the actual shutter.
Right, so it's a mix of blur, and then the flash is so quick that it actually creates a sharp-edged light. Mm-hmm. And boy, the combination works beautifully. Years of watching cartoons have taught us that when something is moving in one direction, the blur is behind it, right?
Are you a fan of cartoons? I never would have guessed that.
No, no.
Beautiful.
The light is coming from the side. It's undiffused. And then you just played with complementary filtration, using the tungsten conversion filter on the flash, setting the white balance to tungsten. You've created that nice kind of tension between the warmth and the coolness of the background. It's just amazing. Then there's the whole thing with the action, the second curtain sink. All these elements coming together to make one very dramatic photograph.
And of course, throw into the mix all of that mechanics and then throw Jackie, a beautiful dancer, and you're starting to really cook.
Right.
Thanks.
What about to freeze the action? What are your ideas for that?
Well, the Speedlights have this remarkable capacity to link up with the cameras at remarkably fast shutter speeds. Traditional sealing for a strobe sync is generally 250th of a second, but with auto FP high-speed sync, we can go all the way to 8,000th of a second and stop action, you know, just stone cold. One, two, three, go. Lovely. Very nice. A couple of strategy points here. I backed off to a long lens. Mm-hmm. You know, a long lens gives power and compression, and this dance move is all about power.
Right, so. Right. An immediacy, that perspective compression gives it an immediacy.
Exactly. Also, you know, with a quick move like this, especially with the power of a male dancer, I'm not going for pan and blur and romance here. I'm going for power, so I gotta nail it. It's gotta be sharp. Right now, this camera's reading 2,500th of a second at f4.
So you have now gone from slow sync through normal sync speeds up into the auto FP high speed sync.
Exactly. So he goes up, we time it, at the peak of his jump, I hit him with not only the speed of that speed light, speed, if you will, you know, and how fast that flash is firing, but I couple that up with how fast the shutter is firing now.
Right.
Okay, again, one, two, three, go. Wonderful.
And of course now, the ambient light doesn't play into this at all, so you've added a second light to come, so you have two speed lights coming from two different directions, because virtually the ambient is not a factor in this whatsoever, because you're at such a high shutter speed.
Exactly. We're probably going to do a few more jumps and try to really get it at the peak of the jump and the most expression of his dance form. All right, let's switch up. Chris, can you get in there? Okay. Let's try again, please. Okay, very nice. Okay, let's stop for just a second. We're gonna get a couple more lights going.
So you wanna add a few more lights so you get a smaller working aperture with the auto FP sync?
Yes, what I'm gonna do here is we're gonna add a couple of lights so we complete, essentially, we complete the rim of light.
Ah, I see.
And also the bargain there is I'm getting more f-stop.
Yeah.
You know, a little bit more.
Yeah, because at 2.8, you're getting part of the body in focus and part of the face goes a little soft.
Yep, exactly that. So I think what we can do is put a couple more lights lower than those two main lights that we have now. We'll keep everything in the same group because we're going to want things running at the same power.
Right.
Because basically this is just one solid rim, and the effect I'm hoping for with the two lights per side will be to extend the rim and make it a line, like a hot line of light all around his very athletic form. Quite a beautiful arc that he's making in the air. So I'm just trying to do that as best as I can. Okay, try to stay in the middle for me. Right there we go. Okay, Chris, your aces, you're done. Bravo.
Now what Joe has done here for the last shot of the day is ingenious. It's getting dark, it's rainy outside, okay. But Joe is simulating late afternoon sunlight. He's placed an SB900 strobe with a tungsten conversion filter outside on the street. Brad's watching it over it. He's using an SB900 on the camera as a master to trigger that flash. Now, because of the angle of the flash, he's got some real specular light coming through here, and he's placed a couple of light and a ladder here as shadow elements, and he's got the dancer bathed in this warm light, surrounded by these interesting shadows. Joe, that is a great solution to the miserable light, basically, we have out here, and creating drama. And who would have thought that light could throw so far?
The light is amazingly powerful. I've worked with these units, and they continue to surprise me, I guess is what I'm saying, because that light is in the street, in the rain, in a plastic bag. I'm translating a signal to it. Exposure, all that information is being translated to the receiver out there in the street. It's flying back through this really huge window, creating the grid pattern, which is important. Distance is important when you're trying to create shadows, because the further the light source is from the shadow, the more clean and distinct the shadow is. Exactly. If I had to put this light in here, the shadows would be all mushy, you know, you wouldn't have any definition to them. So distance is key here. And what we did additionally, because I always am a big advocate of putting your light in a surprising place, and then I don't have a problem with throwing things in front of that light.
Sure.
Like the movie light that we have here, the ladder, we all drug those in and strategically placed them just to create a little
extra shadow.
I mean, why not?
So what you've got is a warm colored light, you've got an undiffused light, and you've got it coming from an outside direction again, and again, using those three elements of control, color, quality and direction, you've created a wonderful, evocative photograph.
A few more, Melanie, and then we're done. We actually could call it a day at that point. Instead of just simulating the end of the day, why don't we do a few more frames and call it a day, all right? Because you worked very hard. All right, appreciate it. Here we go. How about a different move? Slightly different move? Okay, and go. Beautiful.
If you own a camera, sooner or later, someone may ask you to shoot one. Now today, we're gonna explore some tips and techniques using Nikon's wireless Speedlight system to handle these kind of situations. We've got our beautiful bride being made up here in this lovely New England inn. Let's get to work. Hey, Joe.
Hey, Bob, how's it going?
Good, good. So what's our location assessment here today?
Well, we're in a very pretty place. That's fantastic. So what we got here, I mean, Shaney's being made up, and I'm immediately confronted with a backlit, an intensely backlit situation. I'm looking towards windows.
Yeah.
So the first thing I'm gonna deal with is the overall exposure value of the scene, which is in reference to the camera, what the camera's gonna see and how it's gonna meter it.
Exactly, the available light.
Exactly, so let's just take I'll just take an average reading, 0-0 compensation, and see what happens. My suspicion is that we're gonna have detail in the background, but Shaney's gonna go completely out of the picture here. So let's
see how we do. Okay.
All right.
Yeah.
All right, nice enough scene. She's pretty dim. We can't shoot that as it stands right now. But we're gonna have to selectively introduce some light.
Okay.
You know? So, you know.
Alrighty, yeah.
Think of it as available light. It's in your camera bag, it's always available. So I'm gonna give you this.
Alrighty.
All right, that's gonna be your handheld. You gotta program that to, let's go channel one, group A.
All right. I'll get a diffuser.
All right, yeah, that'd be great. This commander now will drive that, okay? So I tell you what, Bob, why don't you come from this side? Because that's the natural fill for this, I think, should come from the window side, right?
Yeah, that's you gotta play with the light. You can't overpower it.
No, we're not gonna fight it. Let's see what we can do. Okay, Shaney, I'm gonna ask you to work with me a little bit here, and
there we go. That's awful nice. Good, good, very nice, pretty.
Joe, I noticed that you've changed lenses. You're not using the 70 to 200 anymore. What have you got on there?
Well, I switched over, Bob, to an 85 1.4,
And that lens is, it's extremely popular for weddings because you want that limited depth of field romance of the, you know, soft, you know, very pretty. And I'm actually coupling up or doubling up the softness by not actually shooting shading, I'm shooting her reflection
exactly.
in this old mirror, which is going to impart its own set of imperfections and might be a little dreamy and very pretty.
Which is exactly what you want in this situation.
Could you go back to the other eye? That kick of the head was beautiful. So there's one of our results, Bob.
Yeah, and it's dynamite. It has such a lovely, soft feel. And I noticed that you were doing, you know, playing around with exposure compensation, EV compensation, and not really because anything was wrong, but you were getting different looks by using different flash and ambient light balances.
I was going for kind of a light, open, airy feel. Nothing really substantially, you know, saturated and deep. Here's a detail I shot.
Yeah, the handheld mirror, when you had her pick that up, that's tremendous.
Well, what happens too with at f1.4, another term that gets thrown around when you're working at shallow depth of field is selective focus.
Yes.
You know,
yeah.
That means that at 1.4, I've got just a sliver of sharp focus dropping that right on her eye. Everything else just goes into these pleasing kind of soft colors. There you go. Now, as you look towards those windows here, you'll see I've got a flash out the window. Mm-hmm. That is your key light. Now, I may need you to cheat yourself just to turn your body this way just a hair so I can see you better, but the direction of your head and your vision should be out the window. So it's sort of a profile shot, and I'm working a wide angle shot because this shot, even though it's a portrait, it's really about the room too and the
right.
feel of the light. So that's it, Shaney. Perfect. Very nice. Okay. I think we're doing pretty well here. You know?
Yeah, that looks great. It's almost like a backlight. It really, really mm-hmm. highlights the veil there. And you know, you're going against kind of the logic. The logic would be to use a soft light, but here you're using a very hard light, but it's working wonderfully because of the direction.
It is. It's a really directed light, and it gives good dimension to the room. So let me just knock off a couple more here. Shaney, just a little more that way. And if you notice here too, I'm using a 12 to 24 millimeter lens, Bob, which I have not used so far. It's a really wide view.
Yeah. What about your white balance, Joe? Where are you there?
I went to a cloudy white balance, which gives an overall feeling of warmth to the value of the mm-hmm. light. And I think that's pleasing in this instance because right now we have a mix of lights out there. You know, it's kind of cloudy daylight, but then every once in a while the sun pops out. Then I have a flash. So to unify the whole thing and make it seem, you know, just like a nice filtered light, you know, mm-hmm. I think the cloudy white balance is a nice way
to
go.
Yeah, it warms it up just enough. It looks great.
Let me do a couple more wide, but then I think this also opens up the opportunity, as we were saying. Once you get something lit, change up your lenses. Get a couple of different points of view.
Which long lens are you thinking about, 85 or the 70?
Let's try the 85. Thanks. Okay, Shaney, what I'm going to do here is I'm going to come in a little bit tighter, okay? And I may run into some shadows.
You want some fill?
Yeah, if you can grab a diffuser. Let me just check it out and see how we're doing. Okay, Shaney, this way, here we go. That's very, very nice. Okay, all right. Really pretty, but I think a little too hard.
Yeah.
A little too hard. Let's do this. Let's take a diffuser, okay? Let's just take a big... You know, this is a staple for wedding photographers everywhere, is to use some sort of, whether it's loose material, a bed sheet, a store-bought diffuser, just some milky kind of translucent material. Okay. So let's come between Shaney's face and the light source.
Okay.
Come on in here, and let's see how we do.
So what you're doing now, Joe, is essentially taking that specular light source and making it a larger light source.
Exactly.
Thereby softening it.
Let's give it a try. Okay, very nice. Let's come even closer, Bob. Let's not step on our veil, though. Just really nice, that's great, perfect. You know, Bob, I'm gonna ask you to come even a little closer.
Beautiful lady, beautiful lady. So, Joe, this is a classic situation for your three-quarter bridal portrait. What's your strategy here?
Well, as always, in the back of my mind, moving fast. So use basic equipment, you know. Shoot through umbrella, which I know is going to give me a nice, soft light. Mm-hmm. One of the features of the SB900, which is my main light here, is I can go right into the menu of that particular speed light and program in what they call an even source of light. They've got center, and they've got standard, and they've got even. Even is a nice dispersion of light, even, as it suggests, right across the surface of the light, you know, no variance.
That'll take advantage of the size of the umbrella.
Right. And also, what some folks oftentimes ask me is, hey, you're using the dome diffuser and the umbrella? And I'm like, sure, you know, why not?
Softer the better.
And we're close enough that even a little bit of light loss from the diffuser is not going to hurt us at all.
Sure.
Then behind Shaney, I've got a small softbox, and it's pointed directly down into the ground. It's got a warming filter on it, a tungsten conversion filter, that's going to give me a little warm glow.
Okay, so you've got a big diffuse source, and then you've got a backlight for separation.
Exactly.
I'll let you get on it.
All right, let's take a look. All right, Shaney, here we go. You look absolutely wonderful. Perfect. Let's try a couple of these. Wonderful. So here's our result so far.
It's looking beautiful.
Very nice.
A little directional?
Little directional. So I'm going to suggest or think that the, you know, we're going to give you a little fill light here, Shaney, okay? Just a little beauty glow, a little drama.
Off the floor?
Yep, let's do that. I'm going to use the gold side of this card, okay? And that's going to give us maybe a little bit of warmth. All right, very nice. You know, I think we got a winner here.
You got a winner.
You know, if we look here, we go back to the last one.
Yeah, yeah.
See how that is?
All those shadows under her eye, under the nose, all filled in with that golden glow. And she's actually, well, she's glowingly beautiful as it is, but now the light is as well.
Yep. Okay, not an opportunity to be missed. Big smile, here we go. Stay with me now. My overall setting here for my camera, I'm shooting fast. I'm shooting at a 250th of a second, 4.5.
Okay.
The 250 X's out all the ambient light.
Right, you're completely negating it.
Right. The 4.5 gives me a little bit of depth of field because here I've got flowers, you know.
Right.
I've got the eyes,
yeah.
And you know, and the detail on the gown, the pearls. I don't want to go in this instance. We've been working a lot at 1.4 with the 85 yeah. for that dreamy effect.
Sure.
For the formal portrait,
here you need to be a little yeah. deeper with your depth of field. The relationship of the main light to your fill.
It's pretty interesting. What's happening? I've got three groups now, A, B, and C. Okay. A group, my main light, 0.0, theoretically full strength. There's
right.
no compensation dialed in. Okay, B group, I'm running way low, -2.3.
That's the backlight.
Exactly, little bit of glow.
All you need is a little separation.
Exactly, but now the C group, I would have bet money before I started that I would have had to dial that down.
Yeah, you would think that.
But, you know, here we are. I think it might be a function of the distance we have it. It's a little back from the main. It's spreading over that gold surface.
Mm-hmm.
And it's pitching in at just the right, you know,
yeah.
value.
Could be that the camera is smarter than we are.
No, that's not.
Okay,
no.
All right.
Come
all right.
on.
Go back
Don't
to work.
Go back
anyway.
To work.
Good luck.
All right, let's relax for a second. So we've cropped in a little bit to the flowers.
Yeah.
Still have the portrait
yeah.
and have a really nice expression on her. Let's see how we did in terms of, you know, just kind of covering in terms of sharpness. I think we're right there.
Yeah, it's looking really nice. Boy, that low fill really makes a world of difference. It just puts that finishing touch on it.
Very nice. I'm not sure we need to go further because we got to get her to the church.
On time.
Okay, now Shaney, just look at me. Beautiful. Okay?
Joe, I have to admit, you don't see many wedding portraits that involve horses, but you really took advantage of the location.
Why not? I mean, there's no law of nature that says when you shoot a wedding, you have to be locked into the traditional, you know, group portrait, three-quarter bridal portrait. I like to freelance my situations as best I can. And it comes from years of you know, being a photojournalist, apply those skills to any situation.
Now you had some nice soft light going there, but still you used a speed light. Can you talk a little about that?
Sure. We started off, and here's the beauty of the system. We migrated really through several stages of light. We went from pretty intense backlight into open shade, effectively, as the sun kept going down behind the trees.
Right.
And, you know, you could probably make an exposure, an available light kind of a situation out of this, but you'd risk, I think, By getting detail into the shadow side, you'd risk blowing out the highlights of the white gown, the white horse. So the solution to me is apply a little light from the camera position, almost as a gentle fill, really not a big main dominant light.
Right, well you used an umbrella to diffuse it, so it was a diffuse fill. It was very close to her and the horse. And when the horse calmed down, it made for a beautiful portrait. Did you use flash value locket near the end there?
Exactly, the camera sees a frame, but with the horse's head moving, for instance, that aperture priority reading is going to vary, it's going to fluctuate.
Right.
But I wanted my flash oftentimes to stay at a certain realm or a certain value. So flash value lock is a feature on the CLS system linking to the camera where you can go into the camera menu and you can program that flash value lock to be hot or active when you press, say, the function button on the front of the camera. So all I have to do is tap one button and I can lock the value.
So the speed light puts out the same amount of light no matter what happens to the available light reading.
Exactly.
Very helpful in a quick moving situation like this. You got one more in you?
Oh, absolutely.
There's one around the back, right?
All right, let's give it a try. Just lift up the veil. Just kind of play with the veil just for a second. Go, go, go. Let your arms go and just let it stay right there.
Joe, for the last shot of the day, you came down to this beautiful natural setting. You had a lot of beautiful light on the mirror-like surface of the lake. You brought Cheney in among the ferns. Can you explain how you kind of brought the two light levels together?
Sure. Lots of disparity in terms of the zones of exposure.
Right, the back was much brighter than the foreground.
Right. Now, you could slam away with a speed light, you know, bring the exposure in the foreground, you know, up a whole bunch of levels, but then you lose the background and you lose this. So it's kind of meeting in the middle. We set up a light panel, 3-foot by 3-foot diffuser, and we put two speed lights through it. Not for power purposes, but what I do sometimes with a broad surface like that is I increase the volume of light.
Down. Stay just in silhouette, just like that, please, Shady. Okay, just so you guys know, I'm killing the main light here.
The third speed light was kind of this wing and a prayer sort of thing. Oh, maybe we could try something. I'm always willing to try something once. So we located that speed light directly behind Shaney's veil. And we colored it with a very warm gel. It's a tungsten conversion gel, as a matter of fact. And hence now I have a golden glow coming through the veil.
It did almost look like the last rays of sunset just coming back from the backlight. It kept the feeling of that backlight, but the front light was nice and soft and even made for a beautiful photograph. And yet, you know, you're out here in the woods and it's the same basic approach. A nice soft light from the side, a little kicker rim there, applied in so many different situations, but the basics are always the same.
It is. I mean, lighting is one of those things that oftentimes presents, you know, problems or mysteries, but they're very solvable. Think of it in pieces, and that's actually the Speedlight system enables you to do that because I'm thinking, okay, my main light's group A, I have to dial that in. I've got another light here in group B, dial that in, and then you start to match those exposures.
Now, Joe, at one point you went to a really high-tech solution, the good old-fashioned king-size bed sheet. What was your thinking on that?
Diffusion is diffusion. Can come in many forms, as we've seen. In this case, we grabbed a white bed sheet, hung it between two stands, and then we brought two speed lights directly, really over my shoulders. She is very frontally lit, and it's oftentimes a very, very flattering way to light someone because it's a very full and soft light right on the subject.
And again, it's a giant light source. Now you're talking about something at least 6 feet square there, so it becomes a very soft light, and the results really showed that.
Yeah, I mean, it's wraps, and it's pretty, and it's soft. You know, you can improvise almost endlessly when you're in the field, and you need to. You really need to.
Yeah. Well, speaking of wraps, I think this day is wrapped. Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks, sir.
All right. That's a wrap.
That's a wrap.
Here we go.
We're here in Gloucester Harbor, and this is the oldest fishing port in the country. It was founded in 1623. Now, Joe's found this fantastic old fishing shack, which can't be much younger than that, and he's found an interesting old salt for a portrait subject. So let's see how he's handling it. Joe? Joe, what's your location assessment here with the shack? We've got some open shade here.
Well, I'm actually very thankful for the open shade. And as you know, a big part of this game is just recognizing good light when you see it.
Exactly.
And then you can use these units. They're pretty intuitive. You can tweak and push and pull that available light to your advantage. So we got really nice patina, you know, and we got nice detail. All I'm trying to do now, I think, is just try to light our subject a little bit selectively.
Yeah, because the basic quality of the light is diffuse, so we have the soft light, and I guess, but you're still some shadows, maybe.
Yeah, if we look at, you know, you'll see our subject, Richard. He's got great character-driven face. He's wearing a ball cap. Ball caps,
You
know?
Yep.
You gotta get some light in the eyes. So what I'm thinking I'm gonna try to do for my foreground light is take a little flick, just a small amount of power out of SB600, and bounce it off the floor. As we've already talked about, you know, sometimes that low light is a very effective way to inform the face, fill some shadows. Also, what I'm doing, because the interior of the shack here is so interesting, I want to pump a little light into the interior. So I'm going to fly a couple of units through that window and just give a little bit of detail. You know, the thing about all photos, as you know, is depth. You know, something going on in the foreground, the middle ground, the background. So I'm going to light that background so the viewer's eye has a chance to reach back in there. All right, Richard, here we go. Good.
Joe, I see you're using the SU-800 here to trigger these.
Yeah, it's a very effective triggering unit. It sends a really powerful signal that communicates to the flashes, and there's a chance I might get into three groups on this. So I figured I'd go right to the SU, and I can trigger A, B, and C groups from this. Right now, I've only got A and B active, but you know me.
Yeah.
We may get to C.
Okay, cool.
Richard, could you adjust the bill of that cap just a little bit up? Thank you. One of the things, Bob, I know from years in the field, we always have to remind ourselves as photographers, talk to the subject.
Exactly.
Relate to the subject.
You can't fall silent behind the camera, because then they start thinking they're doing something wrong.
Exactly. All right, here we go. Really nice, really nice. Way to go, Richard. A couple of components here, Bob, that are happening that we're doing pretty well. That low light that you're holding, given a little bit of glow, but look what's happened to the interior.
Yeah, now there's separation because of those lights you placed outside the window.
And that looks like daylight. You know, if you got strong daylight coming in the side of a window, it's going to kind of bleach out here and there, going to be highlights and a little bit of, you know, maybe even a little bit of glare. Your eye is accustomed to that. That's what normal daylight does.
Exactly.
Thank you, Richard. I can't resist coming in there because there's so much detail. Can I make a picture of your workbench? All right. So to do that, you know, what I'm going to have to do, Bob, is I'm going to have to change up strategies. I'm going to take this SU-800, which is a real directional signal. I'm going to take this off, and I'm going to do a flash trigger with the SB-900. Because what I'm going to try to do now is photograph inside.
Using the lights from outside.
Using lights outside.
All right.
So
terrific.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to take this signal and fly it out the window and see how we do. Because it's just, you know, it's so interesting inside this shack that I don't want to pass up the opportunity. So, can I have that 900?
Yeah, sure.
All right, it's kind of tight in there, so I'm just going to go in and see if I can make this work.
I'll guard the door. Right.
Richard, if you could, you know, take a step back in here, I'm going to try to make a picture of you at your workbench. All righty. So, all right, that looks great. That looks great. Okay. You know, this is working out really well, but Bob, can I ask you for your help?
Yeah, absolutely.
Let me show you what's going on here. We've got group A coming through the window, and that's creating really
that's
nice
cool.
portrait
Beautiful.
Light.
Window light, yeah.
Really nice light. But, you know, this shack here is like a light sponge.
Yeah.
Light hits these dark tones of wood, disappears, okay? And I want some moody saturation, but I also need a little highlight kind of thing going on.
Okay.
So I'm on aperture priority, and I'm at minus 0.7, because the whole thing is kind of deep. I want to keep that quality, which means now, because I'm soaking down the exposure, I'm kind of driving it down, I got to highlight a little bit.
Yeah.
So that 600 could help us out here.
All right, well, I got it from the first shot, so
we're
cool.
All right, so let's put that, I'm going to put that group B.
All right,
I'm going to program that in here to be a group B light, and I'm going to run it right off the bat at minus 2.
Okay, just for a kiss of light.
Just a little bit, because the last thing you want to do is highlight the background. I want all the attention
all
to stay
him.
On Richard,
yeah.
But I want some detail back there.
Yeah.
This is a perfect way to do it. So again, let's go to a gold or warm kind of fill. Maybe stash it up in there.
Okay.
And you take care of that back of the room for me.
Real nice, stick with me.
All right, Bob, let's take a look. See what that did there?
Wow. Yeah, just open it up.
Just pull the little detail back in within the dynamic range of the camera.
Yep, yep.
Because the meter's incredibly sophisticated in these cameras. Okay, so we got a basic situation for a portrait, but we got a problem, right?
Yeah, backlight. It's a lot brighter back there than in here.
I mean, here's the thing. I'll put the camera on aperture priority, and Leland just look right at me, and I'll take what ordinarily I would think, you know, just be a beautiful picture, and she's gone.
Well, this is a situation a lot of people run into when they're traveling and doing shots like this, where they're trying to show the person in the environment, but the background is so much brighter.
Exactly. I mean, we've got the double whammy here. We've got a green canopy, so we've got light contamination. You know, she's going to look like, you know, she's from Mars, you know.
Seasick.
Yeah, exactly. And also no light up front here, intense light out there. So the natural thing I'm going to go for here is a Speedlight solution. So my solution here is to put an SB900, hot shoe that straight away here, and click it over into being a master. And I'm going to control one light right now.
1A?
1A.
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 Group,
all right.
Cool.
So let's see how we
do. Where do you want the light, John?
Let's do this. Leland, let's move, slide down just a touch, okay? Let's see about this. Bob, why don't we just come from, you know, pretty standard position, like 3/4 kind of high, all right? Leland, just relax, and we're going to go with an aperture priority solution. Here I am at 125th at f10. Okay, it's already a lot better, I can tell you that.
Yeah.
If you look at the first one we did, where she's gone.
Yeah,
then
now
we look
she's
here.
In there.
Okay.
Nice wraparound light.
Okay.
A little harsh.
A little hard. But also the scene is still a little bright. I've got, you know, not only exposure variance here, but I've got a bright sky that's even yet another realm of exposure.
Mm-hmm.
So what I'm going to try to do on my aperture priority setting is I'm going to minus out a stop from the whole scene so I can saturate that color.
Yeah.
So that's my first move. And take away a stop. Let's try the strobe again.
Alrighty.
All right. Looking good, looking good. Way to go, Leland. Okay. All right, not bad, the background scene, but what did I do by taking away one stop?
You underexposed her as well with the flash.
I affected the Speedlight as well. So now, that's an important thing to remember. When you make an input to the camera like that, you're making a global adjustment.
Exactly.
The whole scene saturates,
including
this.
The flash.
So what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna hit that group.
And that you can do that because you can control the flash exposure independently from the available light exposure with the Speedlight system.
Right. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to program +1 into this light, which
All
is going to give me that stop back for the Speedlight up front and let
Keep
me
the saturated
have that.
Background.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Let's give it a try. Okay. Perfect. Very nice. All right.
All right.
Got it back. Got it back.
You've got everything nailed but the quality of the light that's coming from the flash.
Exactly. So let's go to a portable light shaping tool, a little bit of a softening device, and let's see.
Something like this?
You're amazing.
I read your mind.
Yeah. All right. Here we go, Leland. Right at camera. Very nice. Nice look. Nice look. Let's do a couple of those, okay? All right. So just kind of rock and roll here. Look at me. That's great. Perfect.
And Joe, the
Very
reason
good.
This light is softer is because it's larger than the previous source. So the larger the light source, the softer the light, as we know.
Exactly. Nice. Pretty nice. Right. Still a little hard, though.
Yeah.
You know, a couple of ways of curing that. We could bring in maybe a card underneath for a little lift or fill, or we could go to a bigger light source.
Bigger light source.
Let's try a bigger light source.
Bigger light source? Umbrella?
Umbrella. Yeah.
All right.
A handheld umbrella. Real good. Very pretty, very pretty. Let's do a couple light right here. Real nice, good look. Now we've gone from kind of a basic, you know, it's almost like a light of necessity, yeah. You know, when you use that hard light. Here, what we're doing is we're tailoring the light even further. We're using the Speedlight system. We're still in aperture priority. We're still talking wirelessly, but now we have a light shaping tool that's giving us a good quality of light.
And it's diffusing the light beautifully, and it's giving a beautiful wraparound light to Leyland's face there. And her position looking into it really works.
It does. But here's the thing. There's a ton of background in here. Some of it's great. Some it's a little distracting. We'll minimize it by lack of depth of field. All right, let's open up a bit.
That's going to raise your shutter speed up.
Yeah, exactly. I've been able to shoot at, you know, around 125th, 160th at f8. But let's open up the f-stop. And when we open up f-stop, we've got a closed down shutter speed, which ordinarily would tell us we can't use flash.
Right, because it'd be above the normal sync speed of 250th.
Right. Auto FP high speed sync.
There you go.
Great look, great look. Okay, awesome. Here we go. Beautiful.
So Leland looks beautiful, no surprise there. Nice quality of light.
Background is soft, but...
You know what I'm thinking? It leads me to believe that maybe if I even threw it further out of focus, and the way I can do that now is to go to a longer lens.
Yeah.
All right, here we go, gang. Okay, working very well. Way to go, Leland. That's very nice.
Nice look. Very nice. Good, right there. Stay there, stay there. Let me have a couple right there.
Okay, all right. So, pretty quick sort of, you know, situation where we ended up just making a studio portrait. We don't have too many control of the elements here. This is where some of the technology is really helpful. Even though the results here are pretty dramatic, anybody can do this. 2800s, leave the dome diffusers on, Justin clamps, okay? Let's put it up there, yep. That'll be great. Whoops, too much? Right there, right there. Let's try that.
Well, it's come to this. We started in the studio showing you the basics of using one speed light. We added a second and third light. We talked about the direction, the quality, and the color of light. Then we joined Joe McNally in the field to see how it's done. Well, this is Joe's pièce de résistance. He's got 9 speed lights going for this final shot. Let's catch up with him and see what he's doing.
Hey, Bob.
Hey, Joe.
How's it going?
Oh man, this looks like a Hollywood set.
Yeah, with small speed lights. I mean, you can do a lot with these. I mean, you gotta take your time. And a picture like this is building blocks. It can overwhelm you right off the bat if you'll allow it to. But if you think about lighting in pieces, A group, B group, C group, which actually corresponds to the groups that we're using with the speed lights, you know, I've gotta, you know, just think of it this way. You know, foreground, middle ground, background.
Sure.
You know, and so it becomes more logical that way.
Sure, and you got to light each plane.
Exactly. You want to take a look?
Sure.
Okay, so camera point of view is here. Right. You know, I got a D700 with a 2470, so I got the FX format, so I got the whole scene. So I got to be careful with my main light. That's off camera up in here. Pretty simple. You know, umbrella, shoot through. It's going, by the time it gets over here to Richard, who's our main character of the shot, it's going to be nice and rich, character driven. Have some shadows to it. And then I'm seeing all the way down the dock. So once you see something in the picture, you kind of want to light it. You know, you want people to see back in here.
Well, sure. And especially since you're going to be shooting this at twilight, so there's not going to be much available light.
Exactly. So hence, this guy is here. This is also a Group A light. And as you can see, it got it way high.
Yeah, so it's going to spread, light the whole dock.
The psychology of that is that at the end of a dock, you might have a lonely light, you know, almost like a street
like
light.
Like a street light. Yeah,
exactly.
Fantastic.
So we're going to create a little pool of light down in here.
Cool.
All right. Now I found that the deep blue of the boat is soaking up a lot of light. So I got to put a flare.
All right, a little kicker.
Exactly.
Now, a little kicker.
Here's the thing. Angle of incidence, angle of reflection.
You're going to get a highlight.
Exactly. So I'm going to get a little skim off of that. A painted surface is actually very reflective. So I skip that light this way, and I'll get a little separation between my subject and this dark blue of the boat.
A little rim on him, too, probably.
Yeah, that's the happy accident. But we don't tell editors that.
Okay,
all right?
Yeah.
All right? We'll just keep that to us guys in the field.
Exactly. What about the wheelhouse here?
Wheelhouse is obviously completely dark. So I got 3 speed lights up in that wheelhouse. Hopefully it's going to provide that glow, you know, kind of late, you know, fading dusk. in this ceiling area, I've got an SB800, and down to create kind of that instrument glow, I've got two SBR200s. Ah, the tiny close-up lights.
Yeah, with the red gels.
Yeah, they're fantastic for just creating little pools of light. And then to create overall light in a group C, I've got up there on the aerial a couple of overheads, just for some spread to kind of define the area. And so I've got 9 speed lights, 3 groups, foreground, middle ground, background, and we may go further because I'm already seeing there might be some dead spots, so we have a couple waiting in the wings to drop into the picture.
Well, twilight is coming. We better get ready.
All right, here we go. All right. Bingo. Okay. All right. Now. All right, here we go. That's it. Good. Here we go, gang. Okay. Hang on just a second, please. Scoop that, heavy scoot it. All right, bring it in. Loop it around the dock here very quickly. Everything's good, everything's good. You guys are awesome. We're looking very good here. Will, you gotta come way forward in the bow. Okay, right there, that's good, that's good. 8-second exposure, hang in there. Here we go, right at the lens, right at the lens. Hold, 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 hold. Tango. Awesome.
Joe, that was amazing. You were working under a lot of pressure, the constantly fading light, all the strobes, but it all came together at the end.
Yeah, we had to make some significant adjustments. You see here, up in the LCD here, you see the sky, you see where it's just kind of getting dead and gray?
Yeah.
You know, that is a problem. It required some extra work, but I thought I could turn that sky blue by shifting my white balance.
From daylight to tungsten.
To tungsten.
Well, here you've got that rich blue now. The strobes are gelled back to normal. Right. Everything is kicking in. Everything looks perfect.
Yeah, I mean, we got a nicely balanced picture out of it, and we were really, dropping some lights in there pretty quick at the very end. We dropped in the water light, if you recall.
Yep.
Because that side of the boat was going very dark.
Yeah, you were losing it against the edge, but you brought it back. And also, when you brought Will out, the captain, out of the wheelhouse and onto the deck, you added yet another speed light with a snoop.
Exactly. We made a very tight beam out of that light via the snoot and popped. And I guess at that point we'd be up to, 12,
I think 11 or 12.
Something like that. Lost count.
Lost count. And Joe, near the end, as the light was dropping, your shutter speed was dropping to 2 seconds, 4 seconds, and yet the available light and the light from all those speed lights were blending beautifully.
I really rely on the camera. One thing about these cameras, in this fading kind of light, and when it looks, that meter looks up at that sky, it reads it very well.
Yeah, and the blend is perfect. Joe, it's been a great shoot, and you've really made some amazing images, but I think the payoff is to see them printed up big and beautifully like this.
That's the amazing thing now, the digital technology that we have. I mean, the results are immediate. We can see the results in the camera and almost as quickly come out with a positive result, be proud of it, share it with your family, put it on the wall. We're living in an amazing time here photographically.
One of the most interesting things about this week and watching you do your thing is how many different looks you get out of one simple speed light. Like this shot, for instance, this beautiful portrait of the bride. Let's kind of walk back and talk us through that light again.
Well, this is one of those things where I set up a hard light to begin with, just a light out the window, no diffusion. But as we've talked about on location, always try to work a situation as best as you can in as many different variety of ways that you can. So I started with a hard light and a wide lens, and I ended up here with a slightly telephoto, an 85-1.4, very popular with wedding photographers because of the limited depth of field. And you brought in that diffuser panel, just a broad sheet of diffusion between that hard light source and her face.
Another killer one light portrait here out on the ship. This was what, some auto FP high speed sync, I think.
The challenge here was dealing with the light contamination on the boat from the green awning and the fact that we were, I'd say, 6 stops under the main ambient light condition just outside the boat, that bright sunlight. So auto FP sync is
is a perfect solution for that. You can go to high speeds on your way above the normal sync speed of 250th of a second. In fact, you can go all the way to an 8,000th if you need to. I believe we shot this at 2,500th of a second.
Yeah, and there was still enough power to diffuse this light because this was diffused through one of your tri-grips. Now this is a really unusual use of one light because you actually took the light and put it outside of the building to shoot through the window.
Pretty simple, really. The trick, if you will, of the photograph is the placement of the light. I looked around. Windows are where light comes from anyway. Oftentimes I try to mimic that window light or shape it by the use of a speed light placed outside the building. In this instance, it's out on the street. I'm able to translate my CLS signal to it. It's a one light solution with hard shadows.
And the warmth of the color makes it look like the last rays of sunlight coming in through the window.
Exactly.
Now, Joe, this is a beautiful impressionistic photograph. Can you walk us through this one?
Sure. Actually, not that much to walk through. It's a one-light solution.
Coming from the side.
Right. She's a stage or theater person, so she's used to terminology. I told her, here's your key light, follow that light. I'm triggering it from the master or the commander on the camera itself. There's nothing fancy here. There's no umbrella or diffusion. It's just one raw light.
But you did use the rear curtain sync because we get that lovely movement, a little bit of blur, and then she's kind of frozen sharp, so we really get a sense of the movement here.
Exactly. One thing to remember when you're doing this sort of stuff, you're following someone, start that panning motion with your camera before you actually squeeze the shutter. Because if you're waiting there, you'll either miss it or the action might be a little bit, you know, not as smooth. So if you're moving the camera, that rear curtain works with you, and that slow shutter speed just follows her, and then of course the flash freezes her right at the top of her jump.
And I think one of the things that makes this picture so dreamy is what you did with the color balance. Now you went to a tungsten color balance to get that beautiful blue in the background, but what did you do on the flash?
Well, I warmed the flash up to bring her skin tone back to a fairly normal sort of flesh tone, but you're right, the tungsten balance for overall casts that kind of dreamy blue. You know, so for me, dance is kind of dreamlike anyway, and the color balance here just helps that out a little bit.
Yeah, so it's always that same three basics, isn't it? The direction of the light, the quality of the light, the color of the light. We've been talking about that all week. Joe, for this last shot of the bride here, what were you thinking here?
This we did get a little bit more complex. For this, I used a light panel or a fairly broad piece of fabric, if you will, as a diffuser. And I put two lights through that. I didn't do that for power purposes because I'm still commanding them from the camera. I'm telling them their f-stop. What I do sometimes in that situation, I put the two lights up just to simply increase the volume of light. That will give me more spread, more wrap, more diffusion.
Sure. And I think you were also dealing with a very bright background, so you needed to raise the level of that light there.
Exactly. I kind of limited my depth of field by using a longer lens so that background goes very pleasing, kind of greens and, you know, out of focus in the background. Your attention goes right to her.
The icing on the cake for me, though, is what you did with the veil here with the backlight. You had another speed light behind her, which was gelled with a conversion filter, again, a little warm filter, and it just has that feel of a last ray of sunlight coming through there.
It's a tungsten conversion gel that I put on the SB900. The speed light's directly behind the veil, and naturally a fabric like this is made to be backlit. So I took a little bit of a chance, you know, because the sensor for that speed light is actually directly behind her. So the strategy there was to take an SU800 and extend it via the SC29 cord. So we got that signal just around her and we're able to trigger that and still retain the ITTL solution.
Worked like a charm. Ah, the rugged old salt. Look at him there.
He's
wow,
great.
That just glows, that picture.
His face is just as battered as this old shack, really, and it's a good match.
Now, even though this looks like an available light photograph, the most interesting thing for me is when you do these doorway pictures, often what's inside goes to pure black, and yet we see a lot of detail. How did you achieve that?
Well, part of the beauty of the location is all the stuff that's inside. I wanted to pick that up. So there's a window just around the side of the building. And I ended up, because I wanted a big pop of warm light into the interior space of that building, I used three speed lights. And I can trigger them all again from my camera position. So that's what's picking up the interior. That left us with the problem of how to light him.
Right, and we had open shade out there, which is generally considered to be a kind of a soft light, but it wasn't quite soft enough for your purposes. And I remember we put something on the floor there.
In that open shade, what you have to be aware of as a photographer is oftentimes that light will have a bluish cast, a little bit cool. Mm-hmm. This all speaks to warmth. So when we threw that fabric down, it had a gold side reflector. And that picks up, you know, any light that's coming down there is going to come bounce back up in a warm way. Then we complemented that even further by you were holding the SB600.
600, bouncing it off. That floor fill is one of your kind of signature techniques, and it comes in useful not only in beauty portraits, but even something like this.
Sure, it gives a lot of detail, and also it helped me out because he's wearing a ball cap.
Yeah.
You got to get a little light in those eyes. Yeah.
So four speed lights going on this one.
Yep.
And here it is, the magnum opus. You had about 12 speed lights going here by the time you were finished. This is just a killer shot, and we were working at twilight. Twilight was coming on you fast, and well, if you can remember, could you tell us where we had our speed lights here?
Well, I think we could quickly go kind of piece by piece, which is actually the only way to solve a problem like this and keep it together in your head, solve each area or zone of the photograph in turn. And when you have light dropping like this, it's dropping like a stone, and this is again where the CLS system for the speed lights will work with you because it's an automated, you know, if I had to run around and change all these exposures.
It'd still be there.
Oh, man. So get your main light first. Always a good strategy. So I positioned him, I framed up the photograph, and in this instance, I did lock the view down on a tripod. So I've got our old salt up front. He's looking at the camera in a portrait mode. So I lit him very simply, a shoot-through umbrella. Okay, that's one piece. Then I realized I had the whole dock to deal with too. So that's gotta be accent lit, you know, not so much broad sources, but little spotlights here and there.
Yeah, you had a snoot going here, I remember that. You had one going on Will, the captain.
Right. We had a couple in the wheelhouse. And then if you recall, up on the aerial, we had a couple, I just call them top lights, just an overall broad cover light. Yeah. And there were two units up there.
And then you had one back here glancing off the boat to give us that highlight, angle of incidence, angle of reflectance, highlight.
We were almost all set. I thought, you know, you always think, okay, we're done. And then I made a picture and I realized that in the darkness, the far side of the boat just disappeared, you know. So then we actually took a chance. We took a stand and we just grabbed the light and we put it down near the water line and just bounced it literally off the water.
Well, the whole shot just came together just as the light was fading. You got it in right under the wire. I think what's been really interesting this week is how we kind of started in the studio talking about the basics of light, the direction, the quality, and the color. Talking about some of the basic rules and then catching up with you in the field and watching how you apply those rules and sometimes break them in location situations to make really creative photographs.
Out on location and also in the studio sometimes, improvisation is the word of the location photographer or any photographer really.
Yeah, it was a fun week. Well, I hope you've enjoyed this DVD from Nikon. And I hope you'll be inspired to go out and try some of the same techniques with your Nikon CLS Creative Lighting System. On behalf of Joe McNally and me, Bob Krist, and Nikon, happy shooting.